Good morning or good afternoon if you're in Europe. Good evening if you're in Asia. This is a global webcast. I'm Matt Winston from the Stan Winston School. I am sitting here with Tom Woodruff Jr. and the great Lance Henriksen. Not to say Tom isn't also great. Oh. They're both great. And we are on the set of Harbinger Down, directed and written by Alec Gillis, Tom's partner in crime over at Amalgamated Dynamics. And we are very excited to be bringing you guys on a working movie set today. We're going to be hanging out for about 2 hours. You're going to get a good chance to talk to this guy, Lance, Tom, the rest of the cast and crew, and we're going to see the set. You don't have to sit here for 2 hours.
I'm joking.
How is it a working movie set if we're sitting here for 2 hours?
For 2 hours. Yeah, nobody's working.
No work being done, man.
Can you guys, movie makers.
Yeah, we're doing the real work over here. Promotion. I'd like to, obviously, these guys don't need any introduction.
A little bit of apple.
These guys don't need any introduction, but I'm going to do it anyway. We'll start with Tom Woodruff to my right, the handsome gentleman right there. Tom is one of the leading creature effects artists in Hollywood. He has been at this for, 30 years now, Tom?
Yeah.
In addition, he is one of the leading suit performers in Hollywood. He's played Pumpkinhead, countless aliens, and things, and creatures, and gorillas, in films.
Mm-hmm. So my biggest suit was with New Line Cinema over playing Goro.
Goro.
It was a law suit.
That's right. we have lawyers on staff, and we'll check all that. Here's the films that the man has worked on. The Terminator, Spider-Man, Aliens, Castaway, X-Men Origins, Wolverine, Predator, Superman Returns, Starship Troopers, Alien 3, Jumanji, Alien Resurrection, AVP, Alien vs. Predator,
sorry to interrupt you.
And so on and so on. The man has won an Academy Award. He's one of the greats, and he's one of the producers of this film. Sitting next to him is...
He won an Academy Award?
Yeah.
He does. Right, he's got a pretty statue.
They used to give him away
They
lollipops.
Just made me a member of the Academy.
Well, congratulations.
He might get another one.
What are you voting for? Lance Henriksen, sci-fi and horror icon, truly. This man has been working as an actor for 50
Stop
years.
Stop it, no.
But he's only 47, ago. Which is, I don't know how you do
oh,
that.
Oh, they're rolling.
We have to talk quieter.
You've seen Lance in The Terminator, Aliens, Alien 3, Dog Day Afternoon with Mr. Pacino, AVP, Alien vs. Predator, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, Scream 3, Network, Dead Man, Hannibal, The Quick and the Dead, The Right Stuff. He is truly one of the great character actors in town and the star of this film. Guys, tell us a little bit about this film, and then we're going to go to the set and watch them shoot.
I'm glad he's whispering.
We're gonna
leave these boards.
He was
bragging too much for me to take, man. Whispered it all. Good.
So go ahead, guys. Talk to us about this project.
This?
Yeah. What's so exciting about this?
We're crab fishermen up on off the coast of Alaska. And we pull up something in our net. But I'm not gonna tell you what.
Something scary, I assume.
Yeah.
And deadly.
And I play the captain of the ship, obviously. Gray. Beard, suspenders.
This is extensive age makeup, by the way.
This is a great company. I love this company.
And how about you, Tom, from your perspective? What is this film? Why is it exciting?
Well, for us, in terms of the technical achievement of this, it's exciting because it was totally funded through crowdfunding, through Kickstarter. It was done primarily through fans of practical effects. People that love the kind of stuff that we do that we honestly just don't get enough of a chance to do that much anymore of because everything has sort of been overtaken by the tidal wave of digital effects. So this is kind of our chance to come back and say, wait, there's another way of doing these movies and to make them more personal and make them more emotional because it's not about the spectacle of a gigantic effect. It's about the visceral thing that kind of hits you in the gut, and there's some amazing stuff that happens throughout the course of this story that affects our characters on a one-to-one basis rather than affecting an entire city of people at the same time.
Well, on that point, Lance, you've spent a lot of time on sets with monsters and creatures, and I'm sure
and with these guys. We've done about almost 9 or 10 things together over the years.
And you know, reacting against a green tennis ball is a lot different than having something.
I've done the green tennis ball.
So tell me about the difference.
There is no difference to me, because when I did theater, we had no money, so we painted everything black, put a chair in the middle of the stage, and did a play. Mm-hmm. So it never bothered me whether it was black or green. You know, it didn't bother me. But it isn't. It isn't.
It's really hard.
Pleasant. And movies don't have language. Movie has, you know, is all reactions to things, right? So how much can you react to a tennis ball? I mean, you know. And then they kind of always cut it right on a kind of an acting mood, and, you know, like a, what do you call it, melodrama thing, and then do spectacle, you know. And I feel about spectacle, by its own nature, is self-defeating. Mm-hmm. I always thought CG was going to be only things you couldn't do any other way. Mm-hmm. Like poetry, you know, poetry is concise and tight and not spectacle. I mean, it can elicit spectacle in your body, but not, you know what I mean? Mm. And so as an actor, I think of it always as being, let it serve us, but not take us over.
Well, this film is—it's great that you're talking about this—the idea of spectacle versus smaller, sort of contained entertainment. And this film is a small-budget film. Alec, when he wrote it, said, "How can I create a film that can be set in one place?" So it all takes place on board this ship, which you guys are going to get a chance to see over the broadcast.
Yeah, this looks real small-budget, doesn't it?
No.
No, it doesn't.
No, it looks amazing. No. They've taken it. You're going to see it looks amazing, but he contained it, just like all great horror movies.
Well, and he was also very smart in that he started the Kickstarter campaign. He went to the fans and said, we're going to do this, and based on what you guys are comfortable bringing to us in terms of funding, that's going to shape the story. He wrote the script to the budget instead of trying to fit, you know, something way too big into a tiny shoebox. Mm-hmm. You know, he did it that way. And you know, the when you've talked about the thing with the tennis balls and the artifice of acting when there's not somebody, you know, because so much of acting, and you know, because this guy's a very accomplished actor, going back and forth, it's so much more important. I did a short, you saw my short, where we had two characters, two CG characters, so we had a green tennis ball mounted on two C-stands. And it was a very emotional scene, and I had to go and it dropped to my knees in front of these balls. So I'm on my knees, and the balls are hanging right here.
Oh.
In front of me.
Watch it.
Oh, yeah, I don't want to give it away.
Now, guys, we promised you a movie set visit, and we're going to deliver. We're going to be coming back here for interviews as we take breaks in filming, but we'd like to, and we'd like for you guys to accompany us. We're going to head over to the set now. We're going to cut to a different camera, which is actually on the set where Alec is shooting a scene right now. And you're going to see Video Village, a little bit of the set, and as we can, we're going to call the cast and crew over off the set, Alec off the set, to discuss the scene they're shooting. And then we'll come back here for more interviews throughout the day. But you guys cool?
That was it?
Yeah.
No, we're going to come back here, Lance.
I mean, but now that was it?
Well, because we got to go to the set, but we're going to come back, I promise.
I'm hungry.
Well, you're going to be able to chew on this for the next 2 hours.
Okay. Can you do the old, like, vintage John Cameron Swayze?
Copy that. We'll be back.
Cue from the crew. Let me know when we are live on the other camera and ready to switch over, and then we'll get out of our chairs.
As soon as Mr. Winston stops talking, we'll be back.
So give me a signal, guys. In 10 seconds, we're going to be sending you guys over to the set where Alec is shooting, and we'll join you, the three of us, over there.
Okay, so let me tell you more about the ball.
So
I'm on my knees.
Oh, yeah.
And I've got the green. And right,
there's children watching.
But they're right in front.
Stop
right,
it.
And I'm supposed to be.
Stop it.
I'm supposed to be weeping.
Okay. Oh, you are
guys,
good.
Is that over?
Got the green balls. What a
disgusting
character, man. Hello.
Oh, shit. Are we live? I think we are. Hi, guys. I'm on set right now. I don't know if you can see me. Are Are we live on this camera now?
We're not to the arms yet.
Okay.
It's a really very private moment in there right now. There.
Are we live on this camera?
Yes.
Hey guys, bear with us. This is a working movie set. I'm here with Lance and Hadil Retta, one of the producers of the film. And Tom Woodruff Jr. is here too.
That's the engine room over there, by the way. This is the engine room. You see the engine? Giant diesel. We built all of that. We didn't borrow any of that. Built it.
Yeah, we're not.
I'm so cool.
We're not on the set of a real ship.
We're so cool.
Can you talk to us about the art department, Tom, who you guys brought together to pull off these miracles? Mm. Do you know?
Is Kyle around? Kyle, and talk about with him because this guy is like a one man show. He designed it. He brought in this amazing crew. They put up all these flats. If you could see the whole space right now, there's like five different little sets, five different sets in place here, so we can just run from one set to the next and keep things moving. Always keep things moving because it's the only way to get the information, get the material out there to tell the story in the amount of time that Alec has to shoot.
And I'm going to peek in there and see if we might be able to push in a little bit with this camera. I don't know what we're seeing right now.
Yeah.
I'm going to peek. If it's creature stuff, okay. We'll have to be careful.
Yeah, it is creature stuff.
Excuse me.
Do you know what's really weird? I mean, with this camera and what we're doing, it's almost like we're sneaking on a crime scene.
Alec, I know you're in the middle of very important stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
You can only see so much.
Can we get Alec in the light right here in the engine room? This is Alec Gillis, guys, the director, writer of this film. And
I'm finding my light. See? Does that work?
No.
Trying to sneak out, guys.
No? How's this? Better? This? Front light?
No, this is closer.
Jesus. So no lights. I'm okay though, huh? Well, welcome everybody. I'm standing in the only entry to the engine room. This is Yuri Everson. Look at—he's a zombie today.
Yeah.
Yuri's here rigging. Say hi to everybody.
Hi, hello everyone.
Yuri's rigging an effect right now.
Do you want two separate holes or?
I think
like an oblong kind of eight sort of like connected infinity sort of thing.
If it's we said it had to be holes because it's a reverse, right? We're planning a reverse action shot.
Yes.
It should be a hole, and if it's two holes, it's just more drag, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
I guess it could catch and pull out.
How about one figure
one big
80?
Enough for both of them?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Eight. So.
So tell us a little bit more about what the scene is. I know you can't reveal too much, Alec, but there are a lot of deaths, obviously. It's a monster movie.
Yes, it's a monster movie, and as we know, it's an homage to John Carpenter's The Thing and to Ridley Scott's Alien. So, there's got to be an engine room. There's got to be guys walking around with flashlights and a monster, all that stuff. But hopefully we're giving it some life and a little bit of a fresh perspective. And it's not just simply a rehash of a bunch of stuff you've seen before. I think we've got, aside from a great cast, I think we've got some fun, some very cool deaths, some unexpected moments. And
Is this Atka's death? Do you want to give us
Atka.
Atka's death. Can you give us a taste without revealing too much?
Yes. it all starts with character, as you know. And some of the people, the Harbys, who pledged, said, please, let's have a diverse cast, right? Meaning, as much as we love Carpenter's The Thing, it was all a bunch of bearded guys, right? Which was cool, right? And that had a cool thing. But for me, I do like to have a bunch of diverse characters that, I like to have a bunch of diverse characters. So you have a lot of different points of view, right? And a lot of conflict is possible mm-hmm. there. So anyway, Atka is the Inuit crew member. So he's the local guy. He's an Eskimo, but don't call him that because
don't
he's
do
an
it.
Inuit.
Don't do it.
Right? And so this is a scene where Lance's character and Atka.
Here's Lance right here. Are you seeing Lance? Yeah. Okay, good.
And by the way, Atka's played by the wonderful Edwin Bravo, who's a totally cool guy and has an awesome beard.
A mighty beard.
A mighty, mighty seafaring beard. So they're going down into the engine room because something bad is down in the engine room, and somebody's got to die, and it's not going to be Lance Henriksen, all right?
No.
Sorry,
well,
Edwin Bravo.
No, we were looking for Roland, who's the engineer. He's the guy that runs the... And there's no sign of him anywhere.
Because
so
something
not,
bad might have happened to him.
May have happened.
May.
We
maybe.
Don't know.
Maybe.
No, we can't predict
we don't know,
anything.
But if you got a name like Roland, chances are you're going to die early.
You don't name your hero Roland. I'm sorry if there are any Rolands watching.
Wait, isn't that what's the
oh, Roland Blancafort? What?
No, yeah.
Roland Blancafort.
No, Roland, La Chanson de Roland.
Oh,
right?
Really?
Yes, he was the warrior.
Oh, right.
He was a
Roland.
Warrior or something.
So
oh, or something. He was a warrior.
So maybe Roland is a good hero's name.
You're assuming that Atka dies.
We don't know. We don't know.
We don't know.
He might live.
He's going down there with the threat of death.
The threat of
death.
Which is dangerous.
And we don't know that Roland died, but Roland has a bunch of sloths. That's his favorite animal. All over his locker. Yeah. We can't figure him out. And he wears headphones all the time, so we don't know. He could be anywhere.
Yeah. He's kind of a creepy guy, and lo and behold, there's pictures of sloths all over his walls.
Yeah. Sloths are so creepy. What is it about sloths? They're so slow. It's
He personalized it.
Can we peek in without showing any creature stuff if we frame up? Is there
maybe,
any? If we maybe slowly without seeing anything, Johnny will frame judiciously.
Kyle in there too.
Come here. Come here.
Follow.
Come here.
Follow Alec. We're
come and take
see.
A peek.
So this is, right here is our engine. And this is all the wrong lighting, you understand. But there's our engine over here. Here's some control panels and things that the boys have put together. Our production designer, Kyle Wilson, and his team of crazy workaholics have done a fantastic job on this stuff. Danger over there in the corner. Thank you. I want to show you something, though. Something really cool here. I'm going to film right here where you guys are. Lance brought this piece of plaster wall dressing to us. If you tilt down right there, see that? We vacuformed it. That was in the sets of Alien 3. So we thought this would be a cool little homage to Alien 3.
Heard of it?
That comes courtesy Lance Henriksen, because he acquired that and has had it in his home for a while. So we slapped it on the back of him. So we got a lot of little homages to both Alien and The Thing. I don't know if you...
Super former.
I don't know if you... Have you been into the galley?
We're going to take them in there.
Okay. This is becoming the roving cam, isn't it?
Yeah. Is that kind of okay?
You bastard.
No, we're not. We're not. We're okay. Just because I mentioned Kyle's work before.
Oh, we've been looking for you, Kyle.
So this is our production designer, Kyle Wilson. And you talk about the sort of like the family spirit of this thing. I met Kyle like 6 or 7 years ago, right?
Yeah, about that.
I go to one of my daughter's middle school plays and like, Alice in Wonderland. These sets are fantastic. Look at the painting on them and the construction. So I was like, I got to meet, who did this? I go to the teacher. I met Kyle, right? And him and his brothers and his dad at the time, I guess you guys still do that kind of stuff? You still do stage and community stuff, but pretty soon he got, you know, swallowed up, so he's working on features now. And he got married about, at the beginning of this show?
Like 6 7 months ago.
Okay,
6 or 7 months
ago. Yeah.
Thank you.
So Kyle has and the entire Wilson family have delivered above and beyond. Tell them about your dad.
My dad's done art direction mainly for advertising, but he's worked on a couple features here and there. But he went to art school in Pasadena, and I've just absorbed everything from him. But
and he's our lead painter, Tom Wilson, and he's just done a spectacular job on this. Every time I'd walk through and more paint would be, he just takes like boring flat surfaces and turns them into metal or wood or whatever you have, and it's just been really exciting to have this kind of talent. And what were there four Wilsons working on this show? Every time I turn around, there's a new Wilson brother there, right?
Just keep popping them out
and banging up the sets. And
do you guys have a website for people to contact you? And
can we do that? We should.
No,
All right, well, keep us posted because you should work more. This is incredible.
He will. We're hoping to, you know, to do this.
Sorry, there's a camera right here.
Hey, what's up? Hi.
Do you want to introduce Tim? Or are we about to shoot?
I got to get something.
Well, wait, no, this is more important.
God, we love him.
Okay, go.
Okay.
John, go do your monster thing.
So anyway, I'm gonna get back and look over Yuri's shoulder and, okay. and peek in on him.
All right, so we can't look around the corner at all, even if we frame up and don't see anything.
No,
okay,
no.
Got it.
But there's other sets you can go on. With
got it.
Now your roving camera, you journalist.
We're not going to. We're not gonna.
It's very much like
disregard the scene. Your rules.
Remember,
no,
it's very much.
Alex
like the scene.
Is very clear with us that we really couldn't walk
around
the set, and yet that's
more about you guys understand. I just don't want to show creature stuff. Before it's ready to be seen.
Yes, of course.
We will gladly show it to all of the Winston School and the Harbinger Down supporters when the time is right. I want you guys to see it all, but right now it's in a little bit of a, you know, it's bits and pieces and it's laying on the ground and all that stuff. But
we will totally honor that, Alec. I promise you. I'm serious. I'm totally serious.
What was that pause?
No. I'm just very awkward when I'm promising.
And you guys saw the pictures. You guys got a handful of pictures.
Yes, we got a handful
aren't
of pictures.
Aren't they spectacular?
Yes, they are.
And look at Sultan's Facebook.
I sent him a few.
Dark Dunes. If you look at Sultan's Facebook, there's more up there, and there's going to be more coming because we're just cranking out the great footage, and everything's looking terrific. Performances.
Yes.
Performances like this man's performance
and
this man's performance are, it's a dream come true for me. I don't want to sound all corny.
I actually hate him in the movie.
We'll let you, and I hate you, but I love you in real life.
I love you in real life.
In real life, I love you very much.
But this adventure, hating is
we're
really
gonna
an adventure.
We're going to let you work now, and we're going to set up a video village. We won't show the monitor, so they don't see. We won't show the monitor, but we'll be seeing you in action.
That's fantastic.
And we'll get out of your way.
And we'll give you guys a good look later.
Yeah, and then we're going to hop over. They are. And then we're going to hop over to the deck and do interviews. I'd like to pull you in at some point when you have a time.
Okay.
Okay, guys. So now we're going to be flies on the wall. We're going to set up our camera fixed right here in the corner. You'll be able to see Video Village over here, a little bit of the set, but we're going to have to be a little bit careful about revealing too much. This is for you, Johnny, and you, Jake. We want to make sure on the monitor we're being careful about what they're seeing. But you'll be able to hear the action and feel the excitement, and hopefully this will just get you guys that much more excited for when some of the creature sequences are revealed. So, we're going to set the camera up.
Can I clear something up?
Yes, Lance, go ahead.
Hating is an adventure. I meant in the story, not in life. I mean, it's drama is sometimes created by one person disliking another person and not knowing how to do it, not knowing how to be civil. So they revert to the easiest one, which is, I hate you.
And that's great in movies.
It makes for
great movie watching.
It's good on film,
but
not
for life. No.
Hey, Matt.
No. We don't say it out loud. We just feel it.
I hope there's.
Are you showing us behind the scenes stuff?
There must be an astronaut in the movie.
Alex is gonna kill you.
I've gotta get some more stuff.
All right, it's Tom's choice to reveal stuff. I had nothing to do with this. Alex scolded us, and Tom is totally disobeying him. I love you. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Oh, don't show that thing.
I'll tell you a little bit.
You can't show that.
Price.
No, you can't show that.
I mean, he's freaking out.
No, I'm going to rat you out. Hey.
What's going on over here?
Nothing.
Nothing.
What's going on over here? Everything
no, you
okay?
can't show that particular
no,
thing.
No.
Tom,
I think I'm keeping an eye on things.
It's critical. It's like you don't want to tell him you're doing Noah's Ark, but there's this giant boat there.
This is like
don't
being
want to do
high
that.
School. Do you have any cigarettes?
So if we can't do that, what can we do?
Yeah.
We can show that wall.
Can I mention, because you were talking about all of Lance's credits, Slappin' Salmon, is that the name of it?
Slammin' Salmon.
You got to see Slammin' Salmon.
You never saw it before?
I did, and I told you, when I saw, Lance does this, it's a weird, quirky comedy thing, right? But it's not like the Lance Henriksen you used to see. Just see it. It's a great scene where he's...
Where do they find
I play a producer
in
it, which
yeah,
is...
Slammin' Salmon.
A slime ball producer.
Slammin' Salmon.
Yeah. Slammin' Salmon. Yeah. Very funny.
Everyone Netflix
funny.
Morgan Fairchild was in it. And when I first met her, just to see what would happen, I said, Morgan Freeman, I'm so happy to meet you. I never, you know... And she went, yeah. Right on camera. Though.
She's a lovely lady.
Saved it up. Yeah, she is.
So guys, check out Slammin' Salmon. I'm going to watch that. While we're waiting for Alec to talk, do you guys want to talk about
the first time you met back in, 1980, on Terminator.
I have some story. Yeah. The first
you
time.
You were seven.
I was 13.
13, a little baby?
Well, when I first met you, I was seven.
You very young for your age.
It was Mansion of the Doomed, so that was probably 19.
Oh, God. 70. You were five then.
So I met you when I was five.
Richard Basehart and Gloria Graham, and they're gone.
They're gone.
And you're here.
And you had your eyes ripped out. And
my eyes were ripped out by your dad.
Thanks to my father.
Yes.
Yeah. Great and then man. You guys met on the Terminator.
Met on the Terminator. But before that, the first time I saw Lance in a movie was Dog Day Afternoon. It was the first movie that I took my wife, who was my girlfriend at the time. It was the first movie we saw together was a movie with Lance in it.
That was my first movie.
That was your first movie?
And the first movie.
And it was the first, let's see, how far did I get?
There were some
firsts. There were some firsts. So it was right, and then Terminator.
Yeah.
And then Aliens, and then Pumpkinhead, and then Alien 3.
Alien 3.
Then AVP, Beautiful Wave. Lance did a short for me. Did a great piece.
I saw that
for
short. You were in that amazing prosthetic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was great.
Can they see that on YouTube? Is that up on YouTube? Can you guys?
I think it is on YouTube.
The one where the guy's selling, crazy animals.
Yeah, it's called. Oh yeah, and then we have the trailer for Sideshow, which is
Sideshow.
Oh yes,
great idea.
Vintage kind of 1930s period.
Which you directed and wrote.
Which I wrote and directed.
And now Harbinger Down.
I know it's like so many things, but also the other guys came into their lives that I witnessed, and I took part in because they wanted to help. Those guys, The Last Push, they did, which was really amazing little movie. No money, there was no money in that, but they supported it.
Why do you do so many indies? What do you love about indies, Lance?
It's an adventure. You can have an adventure. And nobody's defending the script to the death, so there can be creativity. You're kind of all conspiring to do the best work you can. It's great. I mean, there's nothing like survival. You can go on a cruise or you can be in a lifeboat.
The best.
Which one is the more adventure?
Lifeboat. All day long.
Yeah, yeah.
For conflict and adventure, certainly. But for
survival,
my family,
big,
I'm not going to do a lifeboat.
Big,
we're going to do a cruise
thing,
ship. If my wife's involved, we have to do a cruise ship.
My
wife,
a cruise ship.
She won't do lifeboat.
Well, I'm getting to the point where I like cruise ships too. If there's a good comedian on board.
Yes. A dance act.
But Lance, you also have a great survival story that I read in your book, in your biography, about being left out in the desert. And I don't know
if
that's something you want to. I mean,
there's a wrap up to the story. When I was 16, I ended up. Come on inside here, but don't show.
Shoot
this
block, this corner.
Block
this is good.
Yeah. We got a wall over here.
Hey,
don't show that.
Where are we, Lance? Tell us what this is.
We're in the hold. This is where the crabs would be coming down and we'd be, but anyway, this is a funny story only because I'm an actor and you would think I wrote this as a fake, but the truth was I'm hitchhiking through New Mexico and there's a little roadside thing that says, see the snakes and the two-headed cow and all that. And it was also a little gas station and a luncheonette. And so I went in looking for a job because I was starving, really, frankly, but. Anyway, so they gave me a job, and they had a real cute 16-year-old daughter. And I think the guy that was the man of the house got very worried about her and I liking each other, right? So he decided to take me out into the desert, and he said, you can get amethyst in the desert at this time of the year, which is winter, and it's breaking up through the ground. So you can just go pick them up off the ground. And I thought, oh, well, I'll go. So he gave me four potatoes and a book of matches, took me out to the foot of the Oro Grande Mountains and left me there, 30 miles from nowhere, right? And so I buried myself up to the neck in sand and I had a fire going to try to survive the night. But it was so cold. I mean, I thought I was gonna die. Because it was really cold. And then I'm there and the fire went out and I'm looking down and about 5 miles away I could see headlights. So he had taken me the long way in to lose me, I think. We never found out, but
there is a wrap-up to this story. And I made my way down to that road and hitchhiked away, and I went on to California. Well, come to find out, years later, I had done Omen 2, and I was driving that same road, and I saw the same place, but now the freeway was widened. And now, up on the hill, there's a rock store where they sell rocks and stuff, so I stopped in, and the wife was there. And I gave her a copy of Omen 2. And she looked at it, and I said, "You don't remember me?" Of course not, it was like years before, right? But, and she went, "Oh God," right? And then told me that they had sent out the military and everybody else to try to find me dead in the desert. They were gonna charge him with murder because they didn't find me. I mean, they couldn't find me. But it was all dropped. But I mean, what a story.
Oh my gosh.
And I thought, was he trying to kill me? I don't know.
I think maybe.
To this day, I don't know.
Maybe.
I think maybe.
Teach you a lesson?
But something? He didn't get away. It didn't work.
So
because I'm from New York.
So
shoeshine boy. You can't kill a shoeshine boy.
So independent films are a story of survival with very little resources and making great things happen.
There you
and
go.
That's what this whole thing is. We've been talking
survival.
About
survival.
This film is a mission that everyone shares, and that's to shine a light on how effective creating real creatures is, effective it is to build real sets, how effective it is to use all these crafts that everyone loves. Even if we're all doing this for less than we normally would, we're doing it because we believe in it.
Well, and whether you have a giant amount of money or not,
yeah.
Everything in life is done in baby steps.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks in broad strokes, but the truth of it is, to make a creature, you have to start with a drawing, and you do this part of it, and that part of it, and that part of it. You know, I make pottery when I'm not acting because I'm obsessed on the art of pottery. It is an art. But anyway, the baby steps aspect, whether your budget's big or small, you still have to do it in baby steps.
Yeah.
There is no rushing it. Mm-hmm. You can rush it, but then nobody ever hears about it because it fell into the garbage.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
True.
Now that's a bunch of Fukushima. That's what
I'm saying. Hey, I tried to come to your show.
We worked
till 10:30.
It's another member of our cast.
This is Doc. Hello. This guy,
this is Doc. This is Mike.
This guy's Mike.
Hey,
but I swear to God, we worked from. We worked till.
Oh, back me up. Yeah, because my
light.
I want to
see light. I want to see light. Get over there.
Yeah,
you just
Here, you get on this side. You get on that side.
No,
trust me. Trust me.
I need you.
Go.
Keep going. Keep going.
But anyway, they worked us till 10:30 that night.
They're ready for Lance. They're ready for Lance. You gotta go get on set.
I do.
Oh, Lance.
I gotta go to work. I'll be back.
We're staying here with you, Mike.
All right. Love you, man. Oh shit. Shucks.
So Lance is being called to set. This is Mike. He plays Doc, and he is hilarious in this movie.
Thank you very much.
And we had a wonderful time in this movie.
Did.
Copy.
Still not working, copy.
So tell us about your experience working on this adventure with Alec and Lance and the rest of the Monster Makers and the crew.
Oh, my experience working on this movie was amazing. Just to learn so many things behind it, because I've done little roles, but I was just so in awe that I was just here. I was like, oh my God, I'm doing a movie, wow. And I posted on Twitter, sweet. But now I actually felt almost as like a professional, meaning I was taking everything and I was absorbing it from you and Alec. And then when I heard what Alec was doing, and I walked to his gallery and I saw, I was like, hey, that's Predator, that's Terminator 2, that's Aliens. Who the hell is this guy? And then I looked at his Kickstarter, and then I was like, oh, wow. Because I thought it was, honestly, I told people, it's going to be a short film. You know, I think it's low budget, but it's going to be all right. But then when I, in coming in, seeing the quality of work and the quality of actors and the quality of time and preparation and the set itself, I was like, this is not anywhere near what I thought. This is not a student film on USC like I thought it was going to be.
No.
This is the real deal.
There's a lot of love going on
the
screen.
There's a lot of love going on here.
Or UCLA.
Oh, UCLA, exactly. Oh, UCLA. Of course, I forgot.
And I felt the same way. I mean, obviously, I've known these guys my whole life, and I knew they wouldn't put on anything less than wonderful. But coming to these sets, I know all the actors, all of us, I think it raised all of our passion for this to be here and see the love that was going in. I think all of us realized this is, let's kick butt,
Yeah.
And have fun. It's been so much fun.
Oh, it was amazing. It was so much. I never thought I would laugh as much as I did on a horror film as I did. It was so much fun just to play around with you and to play with everybody.
Yeah.
and everybody has their own stories and own sense of humor and sensibility that they brought to their character and to this movie.
Well, for the deaths to matter, you have to care about the characters, and hopefully we all will, people will care when we maybe die. Maybe. I don't know. I'm not going to reveal anything.
If there's a sequel, we might come from the ashes. I don't know, but it was great. No, it was, and that's what I think. I think the camaraderie and the caring came through more so, and then that raised the film up to a new level.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was great.
I think your character, if I was to describe Doc is sort of like the Bill Paxton character in Aliens. He's a bit of an alarmist. He's like, we're doomed, we're screwed. But it's obviously not that character. But is that sort of your role in the movie?
Well, it's a little bit of that, along with the Yaphet Kotto character, where he's like, look, we really need to assess the freaking situation right here. This is a movie. And he doesn't have any filter.
And for those of you who don't know, Yaphet Kotto from Alien.
Yaphet Kotto from Alien. And he brings into the fact that, look, this is what's going on. This is what needs to be done.
He's a realist.
He's a realist. He doesn't go in there, let's run experiments. Let's see what happens. Like, no, let's run. Hell with running the experiment. So his thing is about, it's a little combination of the two, which I like in the writing what Alec did. He tried to, like, basically meld the two. So he did a nice little fusion of the two. And that was fun for me because just in general life, you want to have that filter where you just say what's on your mind.
Yep.
Say from the gut as opposed to like, it might hurt someone's feelings. No, Doc doesn't care.
Yeah.
He's like, look, this is what I feel.
Yes.
This is what it's like.
Yes.
If you don't like it, kiss my ass.
Because I'm not going
to
die.
I'm not going to die. You might want to. I don't want to die. And are we going to get paid after this chip? That's all I want to know.
Yeah.
Are we getting paid after the crap?
Get an advance on the money? Because it looks like we're not making out of this alive.
I don't think we're going to survive. So if I could just get that in advance, because I got some child support payments I got to take care of right about now.
So before that thing consumes you, if you could just write, just the signature's all I need.
Before my face blows off or something, I just don't know.
Not that any of that happens.
We're not giving anything away. I don't give anything away.
Tom has a bucket.
I found this.
Tom, you're not supposed to show stuff.
It's been Alex gonna kill us. Somebody kicks the bucket.
Oh, will
hey,
you?
What's going on here? Is there something going on? Did I see something?
I smell cigarette smoke from the other side. I think the guy
producer.
Is smoking over the other side.
All right, I'll go check that out.
It's good to know. Yeah. Tell my ass to keep it down.
Hey, we should also mention the guy behind the camera, John Hales, who is a mystic, magical kind of actor himself, because he came into my home one evening when I was watching Mad Men. Just bam. And he's been in The Nutty Professor too, and he's been in
and he's also the creative director of Stan Winston School. John, just show yourself so they know who Tom's talking about. That's John.
There's
Hey, John.
That's our man.
And that's Chris over there.
Find your light, people.
And that's Jake over there.
And there's
Andy over there.
There's Andy. Hey, Andy.
We got Stan Winston School guys all over the place. And a few Stan Winston School girls who you will meet later. Mike, let's peek and see where they're at, because we kind of want to stay in Video Village and see if they're shooting. You want to lead us there?
Oh, look.
Lead us there. Follow Mike.
Want to step down?
Follow Mike.
The non-roving camera.
Yeah. Are they about to roll? Well, that's perfect. We're going to stay here. We're not going to see. So, Johnny, we can't show monitor, and we can't show that.
Out to see.
Okay, guys, we're about to roll, and you're going to hear Alec giving direction to the actor, Edwin, and also the creature crew. He's going to be giving them notes. We're going to have to be careful about what we show you, but this will be a kind of a neat window for those of you who've never been on a movie set to how it goes down. So.
Sneak out. I gotta bust out of here.
Okay.
I gotta get some stuff done for the other film, so.
Oh, yes, Tom Woodruff Jr. is directing his feature debut, Fire City, Interpreter of Signs, starting Tuesday.
It's a romantic comedy.
And we will do a live set visit with you guys if you're up for it.
Talk.
Okay, we'll talk.
This guy's gonna be in that one, too.
Yes.
Thank you. Thanks.
All right, get over here.
Okay.
Tom Woodruff Jr.
with everything. This is all cool.
All right, we're gonna be flies on the wall here. Alex giving final notes to his actors. Here we go. Oh, Scott Brooks here.
Bum, bum, bum.
Be careful on the floor. He's got a lot of slime.
Oh, they do? Okay. I'm not worried about me. I'm worried about you, man. Snap, snap, snap. Is this okay for the arm? Where do you want it?
Let me see that. That works. Can I see that, Ben? Is that... Sorry, I don't know how to get that.
No, you're fine. You're fine. Yeah, I would say on it, though, Lance. I'd kick your elbow up just a little bit.
Yeah, well.
Okay. Okay, that looks good.
Arm good here? This is, yeah.
So just fix your expression and look right here. Here's the creature, right?
All
right. Right? Looks of terror, right? And then, so the cue will be action, which is us to start pulling and you to start pulling, right, Tim?
Okay.
And then I will, hopefully I'll have the presence of mind to say, and neck, and then you got to get rid of that neck, right?
You want this neck off before, obviously, the tentacles go through the chest. Okay, so I'll try to watch where that's going to.
Yeah, so when these are halfway out, we want that neck off, and then these come out.
When do you want me to look forward? From the beginning? From there?
No, not from the beginning. Let's not even have you look forward. I don't know that I'd use that. Because you're already in pain over your arm. You're looking at that arm. Is that being held in the right area?
Are you getting it?
Okay. So the shoes will be ready and action and neck. Okay?
Okay.
Here we go.
And rolls up. Rolling. Final round. 92 echo. Take one.
Okay. Ready and action. And neck. Okay, let's reread, but it was promising.
So I got you guys already.
All right, going again.
I'll cue you much earlier.
We were gone and you were still there.
Yeah, we were just pulling at such a fast rate. It's much faster. Yeah. Can you look at that?
Yeah, I've got to pull 4 feet across his neck.
How much?
You have no idea how frightening that is. To be an actor in a scene like this is just,
we can't let a five minute gap go before someone alerts. It's...
Pull this one. Are you able to pull this one a little more? See, this one's easy to pass. Yeah. Nice. Perfect. You want to throw a little slime on him, Cass? A little more. Just put your hand in there, in the bucket, and smear a little more slime on him for me, please. All the way down.
Oh, Charles.
Yeah, there you go, buddy.
When the glass of music reach the skin. I know you've all seen The King and I, haven't you?
Thank you. Is there a file on
it? So, climb in.
The action was good. We probably have.
Please send Ben here. Benji, you're right.
Are we okay now? Can they hear me on the lav? Are we live on this? Okay. So guys, have we shot a take yet? We haven't seen that? So setting up now, Alec has been rehearsing with the effects crew, with Yuri in there and Tim Martin. Who else from ADI is in there, guys? Do you know? And this is the untimely, unfortunate something that happens to Atka. I can't really tell you what it is. They've been prepping this for the last, 45 minutes, rehearsing it. A lot of coordinating between the puppeteers and the actor and the lighting. So now it's pretty much all set up. They're going to start smoking up the set a little bit, dimming the lights and really getting ready. And we'll watch them do their first take, although we're going to have to kind of limit how much of it you see. You'll be able to hear the action. After that, we're going to cut back to the deck of the Harbinger, and we're going to talk to Camille Balsamo, one of the actresses from the film, and some other actors, and the special effects guy, Frankie Balzer, and a few other crew members. And there'll be time for Q&A. I know a lot of you want to have some Q&A with us, and we're going to make time for that for sure. So if you have questions, please type them in. I'm going to be going through them before the end of the broadcast and trying to answer as many of them as we can, as long as we're not giving too much away. So that's where we're at right now. We're ready to do the first take of this awesome effect, and I'll let you pretend like you're standing in Video Village with us. Pictures? Pictures up! Pictures up!
Rolling!
Now here, aim this at something. Okay, now they're resetting. Alec will make some adjustments. I wish I could show you the monitor, but Alec will kill me.
Oh, you're
it was up
you're
to
in
Tom.
Trouble, man. Okay, that was take two. I'm exhausted.
Are no, you done? You're done? You fried?
No.
You have one take, no. I'm done. I'm out.
No, two. That was two.
Two. They call him two-take Henriksen.
Usually Lance as soon as comes out at this point and starts giving him a nice neck rub.
Exactly.
But it's usually me. I don't know why he waits for her. I said, just go in the car. There you go.
There you go. Now I'm feeling much better. Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
A little more over there.
To tell you.
Just a little more there.
Just right there?
Yeah. There thank you. You got it.
You know what I'm saying?
Mike Spatola's on
God
set.
God bless you, man.
Mike, what's up, dude?
Hey, Mike.
Hey, how you doing, Mike?
He's creeping more toward the opening. Look at this sneaky guy.
He wants to see. So this is Mike Spatola, the makeup supervisor on this shoot. Yeah. How are you, Mike?
I'm doing great, okay. Man. Nice to see you.
Great to see you, dude.
Yeah. You've come back to life.
You've come back to life. We all said goodbye to me a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, right. Can't see the lady.
Now we're here on set to give them a visit. So how's it been so far on Harbinger Down?
It's been great. I'm kind of sad that it's almost done.
Yeah.
You know, we only have a few days left.
With principal cast.
With principal cast.
But then 2 weeks of creature shoot.
Creatures
second
and miniatures.
Stars.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you're a little sad to go back to
teaching.
Mike is the chief academic officer at Cinema Makeup School, who are backers of Harbinger Down. So for all of you CMS people out there watching, thanks for supporting Harbinger Down. And we're going to give you this guy back very soon.
Very soon, a couple days.
Are you going to be cool for a little sit down before the end of the broadcast?
For sure,
so we can talk to you about the
Definitely.
Project. Awesome.
All right.
We got another take about to go off, so we got to be quiet.
All right, thanks.
Yep, ready.
Okay, take two, take two.
All right,
ready, set, go.
Johnny's gonna get us in trouble.
There's no monster over there.
Okay. Take three.
I told you, take three is always the one. I'm being very truthful to my director and my producer. No peeking.
We're not.
That's like, this is like a little bit like protecting a dog that you're washing in the shower from embarrassment.
So you guys have just been compared to a dog in a shower.
Well, a little bit. Something like that, something.
Lance Henriksen, the master of metaphor.
Metaphor,
just compared the crew of Harbinger Down to a bunch of wet dogs.
In the shower.
In the shower.
And you're protecting their vanity.
Hopefully this will be a very scary wet dog.
Oh, kids. So you want to be in show business, huh? My daughter, I was in one of Tom's epics, and she stood around all day long waiting to do this one scene. And she said, Dad, she made this up herself. She was only like 11, and she said, Dad, did they pay you to wait or to work? And she said, I'm never doing this.
For sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, your first scene's up in 7 hours. Yeah, have some eggs.
Yeah. Have you done makeup? Okay, sit around with lipstick on all day until.
What kind of grown men do a job where we got to wear lipstick all the time? I have no problem with it, but I don't know about it. The lipstick and the makeup. Sometimes.
Well, powder maker.
They put too much on me.
And then they put powder on the powder.
And they layer it. And I.
And then they do this to your hair. They go, you know.
There's the fussing and the zhuzhing.
You just brought up something. If I was standing at a bus stop and somebody came up and went like this to me and like kind of wiped my mouth, I wouldn't even move. I'm so used to it. Yeah. It's so embarrassing to say, but it's true.
Well, the
if
next
I'm
time
pumping gas at a gas station, somebody comes up and says, wait, hold on a second, and fixes my shirt and shit. And stuff.
You're so used to being touched.
And the ship that I had in the bottle, they mess with that.
Yeah.
And then, oh, God.
Next time Lance has last looks, you'll see the makeup come over, Michael come over, sound will come over, wardrobe will come over, and everyone's going to be touching.
And you feel like you're covered in ants. You really do. You're rubbed with honey and covered with ants.
But you love it.
Yep. I have a job, though. It's a job.
So we just had three takes. I think we're going to hop on over to the deck of the Harbinger, but we're going to wait till our camera's set up over there. Until then, I'm going to let Johnny stay here with you guys.
Good.
I'm going to head over to the other set,
good. And
we will switch back over to the deck of the Harbinger and talk to some more cast members about the project.
Do you have enough rope?
I'm going to leave you
to
guys
go
here.
Into the
galley, yeah.
Yeah, even the hallways.
Yes,
better.
Yes.
You
want
to do that?
Should we take them there?
You want to go there?
Or should we reset it? And then... So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to the deck. We're going to bring some more cast members on deck interview. If you don't have to work, I'd love for you to join us.
Sorry? You should be a permanent co-host with Matt.
If you can. I don't know if they need you right now.
Oh, man.
We'll call it the Lance and Maddie Show.
Man, Matt.
The Lance and Maddie Show. And we're going to bring some cast members over there. Then we will take you guys into the galley. You can see the corridors. It's really cool. One of the berths where we sleep. But first, we're going to go to the deck and do interviews. Are you free for a little bit?
I'm free.
Really?
I'm free to be
awesome.
I want to give him his space. I want to give him his space.
So why don't we go to the deck, and we'll talk with you.
He's going to give him his space.
All right, I'll talk to them for a second.
The show,
great.
With Dave. I just heard your story about the four potatoes and matches.
Yeah.
That is incredible. That's an incredible story.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I could have died. If I had not noticed, if I hadn't noticed that light's way off in there, I walked through the night to get to that place and get out of there.
How long did it take you to walk there?
Oh, till dawn.
Oh, my God.
And I was trudging through cactus and ravines and you name it. The foot of the Oro Grande Mountains.
And you never, like when you got out of that situation,
I never
you
looked back.
That SOB,
no,
I'm going to...
Never looked back.
and his wife actually thought you might have died out there?
Thought he might have killed me.
And weren't they watching your movies? Or like
no, but I was only I was a kid.
Oh, you're a kid. You were young.
I wasn't 16 yet.
I thought you said it was your first movie. No, did I only heard half
no,
heard
of it. Omen 2, I did years later and went back there and said, hi, you remember me? And she went, ghost.
That kid we killed.
The kid we killed.
He's back.
How many times do I have to kill you?
Yeah, right. Would you like to go out and do some more prospecting?
Hey, are you free? Is he free too? We're gonna fly over to the deck, and we're gonna set you in a chair, and we're gonna do some Q&A.
All right, I'll meet you there, but let me get a. You can start with him. I want to.
And then we'll come grab you. Whatever you want to do.
Sneak up on
us. So guys, right now you're gonna be with Johnny here on set. We're gonna go get our cameras set up over on the deck.
Show business,
Alex's gonna join us, and we're gonna do Q&A. So if you have questions about Harbinger Down, questions about practical effects. Questions about anything, we are going to field those now. You guys have been very patient about Q&A, so that's happening in about 3 minutes. Hang out on set for a minute, we'll go get set up, and we'll let you know when we're ready.
I can't.
Sorry, everyone.
So, Alec?
This is our first live experience
ever. Can we do it?
Ever.
Yeah. I think I have about 10 minutes.
Camille, do you have to work right now?
No, I'm standing right
over
here.
Why?
Because there's
come on. Reed. Big G, all you guys, come on.
This is live. You stay here. I was going to talk to the audience.
Oh, really? Well, you don't have to bring it up. I won't bring it up.
We're going to say, here's Stan Winston's son, Matt. And this other chick.
We should grab...
Yeah.
Hello. Are we on right now? Am I just eating right in front of the camera?
You are eating right in front of the camera.
Oh, hello. Camera's live. I didn't know that with chips on my mouth. That's great. So, yeah, here we are, video. Is my camera live? That's good. That looks great on YouTube. That's great. Yeah, that's nice. As I come. Yeah, catering. Can't get enough.
Can't get enough. We're ready to switch whenever they are.
Which
you're with writer, director. You lied?
I'm not getting audio on too.
Hold, please. No audio.
I need somebody. Sorry.
Come on. All right. Is this live? This is what I'm looking at. Sorry, Alec. Come on. Sound's got to stay with us. All right. We lost sound. We're cutting away. Tell me when, guys. We're back? Gotta do it. Hey guys, are we live over here on the deck? Hey guys, we are back on the deck of The Harbinger with Alec Gillis, writer, director of Harbinger Down, Oscar-nominated creature effects legend. You've been talking to him on set, and we are going to try and field some questions. Because there's some coming in. While I'm looking for some, anything you'd like to say about the genesis of this film would be appreciated.
All right. Well, I guess for those of you who aren't aware of what Harbinger Down is, it is a Kickstarter funded. At least that was how it began, and its most important roots were in Kickstarter. Tom and I, a couple of years ago, were kind of a little bit down in the dumps. After
I need questions.
For The Thing, 2011, we're mostly cut and trimmed and ripped over by CGI. And we thought, I guess this is just sort of the way the industry's going. People prefer CGI to practical effects. We put some videos up on YouTube. They got tremendous response. We started becoming aware.
Has he been mic'd this whole time?
No.
So, I'm sorry. Apologies from our team for that, guys. Alec, just repeat a little bit of that.
Very good. Hi. It's nice to be heard. Now, for those of you who aren't aware, Harbinger Down is a Kickstarter project.
Talk to us.
It has its genesis in the interest in practical effects, which we all share. We know that if you're a Winston School fan and friend, you're also a fan and friend of practical effects. So the basic marching order on Harbinger Down is that we will be using no digital creature effects in this film. We'll use digital in a what we consider to be a support role and a sort of a tasteful, appropriate way. We're a film that has its roots in the 1980s. It's a film that is a tribute to John Carpenter's The Thing and to Alien. It's not an old-fashioned film. It's just that we're trying to capitalize on some of the things that made those films great. Claustrophobia, mm-hmm. A diverse set of characters with different personalities, some that you like, some that you like to hate. Cool deaths.
Yeah. Am I maybe the one you like to hate? Maybe. Yeah,
maybe you like.
Maybe,
one of,
although
maybe.
I tried to make him lovable.
I can't, you know, you brought up. It's hard to not like you. We tried, but we couldn't do it. Practical effects that work for horror films, not digital stuff that might be appropriate for, you know, huge, space epics or something like that. This is a horror movie where creatures are slithering around hallways and people are getting, speared and stabbed and, all kinds of, body mayhem.
Hey, would you mind going through Rat Attack? Because I know you have to leave us and answering some questions.
Sure.
Really, like, the fastest answers you can give.
Okay.
From Joel Champ.
How long have you been shooting, and how much did you raise with crowdfunding?
We raised a total of $384,000 through crowdfunding, and we are in the last week of a 22-day shoot schedule.
And you've also got 2 weeks of creature shooting,
yes,
which is pretty awesome.
Yes.
Coming up.
Coming up.
We've also, this is for us, will this be available on YouTube? This broadcast will be uploaded to our YouTube channel right after the broadcast. So yes, if you can't sit and watch the whole thing, you'll be able to watch it later
And also, by the way, swing over when you get a chance to Studio ADI's YouTube channel, Studio ADI, where you'll see tons and tons of behind-the-scenes footage from our 30-plus year careers, Tom Woodruff and I, as practical effects artists.
And we will be actually adding annotations to this video that will link you directly to that page.
See, that's how
and,
it's done.
And you have a Twitter account now?
Right? Yes, Alec_Gillis.
Alec_Gillis. And also the Harbinger Down Facebook page. You should all like that right now. Harbinger Down Facebook page for updates on the progress of the film. Any other outlets we should...
We have a Harbinger Down website, which is what?
HarbingerDown.com.
Ah, Harbinger let's Down. Try that. HarbingerDown.com.
And again, all of those details are in the video description after this YouTube video is uploaded. So we'll make sure you know where to find everything.
Fantastic. Next question.
I'm looking.
I'm a busy man, Winston.
Vamp. I'm looking. There's a whole list.
Vamp. Yeah, you're sitting on a set that is... mostly paper and wax, cardboard. Some very thin, cheap wood has been used on this, but it looks fantastic. Because to us, it's about what goes on screen, not about how much anything costs.
Can you talk to us about when will this be available? Online or in theaters? This is a question.
That's a good question. It's not exactly a done deal yet. What we're doing is producer Hadil Reda is working on that right now as we speak. She is going to secure a theatrical distribution deal that will
be by the end of the year.
End of the year is what she's telling me.
In theaters.
And you know what? I believe her.
VOD,
when it's ready, not a minute before it's ripe.
Teresa, do you have questions there from Google Plus? Are you monitoring? Because I just lost my question feed here. Eric, can you get me live up again? Before you go, Alec, can you talk about the fact that you're allowing people on set?
Oh, yeah.
And why and what this is all about?
Well, this project is, these are uncomfortable. They look really awesome. I know, it makes me look all directory.
White headphones always look very...
And if that didn't make me look like a director, how about that? The reason that we're letting people come on set and have fun with us is this all started through the online community. We would not have a film if it weren't for everybody in the Winston School audience, the Harbys, right? You know who you are. Those who pledged, those who spread the word. You know what? There's a lot of people who couldn't afford to pledge, but they did their job out there helping us spread the word, and we're eternally grateful for that. We're looking for the new paradigm where we're removing middlemen from the process, and we're involving fans such as yourself, because you have reinvigorated us and our drive to keep our craft alive, and beyond just keep resuscitating and keeping it alive. We want to take it to new heights. We want to move the art of practical effects into the new era. And that doesn't end with just the practical effects. It's like your dad said, if you don't have good story, good characters, the effects mean nothing. Yeah. And conversely, you can have all the money in the world and the best effects and the best gigantic effects, particularly the digital effects, also mean nothing if the story and the performances are no good. So we're going to try our very best not just to be, continue being practical effects artists, but we're going to bring you stories and characters that that we think you're going to love.
Well, you've got a lot of fans out there who are so in support of this, and a few questions are coming in. How much time? Do you have 2 more minutes?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, great.
Maybe 7. I'm a little concerned nobody's calling me. I think Tom Woodruff is now directing this movie.
This is...
Call Fire City.
I wouldn't put it past Tom.
He, yeah.
I'm gonna rat him out. He was showing all the secret stuff behind your back. What? He showed the bucket.
Not the bucket.
He showed the dented bucket and a few other things. Okay, how long did it take to create these amazing sets and prepare them for shooting? That question is from Rockaholic.
Thank you, Rockaholic. If you notice on the Kickstarter campaign, I think we were funded like around June, early June. I had said that as the promise was I would write and direct a practical effects-based sci-fi horror film. There was no script at the time we got funded. So I took about 3 months to write the script. Sultan from Dark Dunes came in with more money, which enabled us to not just be like a one-room little movie or a person in a closet with tentacles coming under the door, but to have some production value. What was it, about 6-8 weeks to build all the sets? Maybe 6 or 8 weeks?
Yeah, I think they started around Thanksgiving, but that was just the initial.
Yep, so 6 to 8 weeks to build everything you've seen here. It's an unbelievable accomplishment. Again, singing the praises of the entire construction crew, the art department, Kyle Wilson, production designer, and people who knocked themselves out getting this thing done quickly. I'm sorry, I'm answering this too. I'm taking too long because
not at all.
I'm ebullient.
Go not ahead. At all. Daniel Copley. Daniel Copley. With you, this and the new Star Wars movies, apparently going to be using more practical effects. Do you think the public is hungering for this? Do you think the general public? Obviously, all of our fans love it and get it in a deep level. But do you think the general public? Maybe.
Well, I do. You know, everybody thinks they have their finger on the pulse of. Generally, human beings think that they represent the majority of the way people see things. But when I'm at a cocktail party, or when I'm sitting on a tailgate at the stadium watching the football game.
Have you ever done that once in your life?
No.
So what are you talking about?
Once I have. No, but when I talk to people and when I say that's what I do, maybe they're just being nice, but they go, that stuff looks so much more real than the CGI. And of course, you know, our crowd takes it to a fevered pitch,
yes,
where we tend to get a little
destroy all computers.
Yeah, I don't follow that credo.
No.
Although we are beneficiaries of it.
Mixing is always the best way.
Yeah, mixing is the very best way. And you look at Jurassic Park, it's still the best example of the mix of digital and practical. They keep each other honest, you know? So anyway, yes, I think the public is wanting this. And the fact that, I think it's Kathleen Kennedy on the Star Wars movies that said they'd be using more practical effects. J.J. Abrams, I know, likes practical effects.
Big fan of practical.
That is an indication that somebody is listening. If you talked to me a year ago, I would have said, studios aren't listening. Who cares about whether they're listening or not? We're going to do it regardless. And that is still part of my firebrand outlook. But the fact that they're saying it, let's see if they actually do it, does mean that at least on a studio level, somebody is saying, hi, Giovanni. Somebody is saying, let's listen to the public and listen to the fans. Next question.
All right, next question for Alec Gillis. Are there miniatures being used in this film? And now we can give some shout-outs to those who are building those miniatures.
I am so excited.
Oh, this question is from Omega Morph. Thank you, Omega Morph.
Okay. I cannot leave until I have to leave, but I'm going to answer this last question. To Omega Morph.
Omega Morph.
Omega Morph! Yes, I'm very excited and proud that my old friend Robert Skotak, visual effects Oscar winner for Aliens and The Abyss. His brother Dennis, I think it was, won for Terminator 2. These are guys, they're among the first people that I met in the industry. They're kind of, I met him before your dad. They're my visual effects mentors. Anyway, Robert Skotak, who has done all those great miniatures for those movies I mentioned, is doing our miniature work in Harbinger Down, which is going to include a ship. It's going to include the frozen sea that the ship is stuck in. It's going to include some environments for our miniature creatures to operate in. These are the guys who did the Queen Alien sequence in Aliens, so they're well. And we worked with them on Tremors when the worm bursts into Bert Gummer's basement. We're doing that kind of thing with them again. Miniature sets with miniature creatures that we create.
How exciting is that? Come on.
Yes.
I love and
miniatures.
And
now I'm being called.
And you got to go direct a movie.
I have to put my white headphones back on.
We will probably sneak over there to watch you in action later on, but we're going to hang out on the
with
deck.
With that roving camera?
Well, we're not going to show anything, I promise.
I want to show you guys everything. It's just I can't do
not
it
just
too early.
Not just yet.
Okay.
Not just yet. All right. Thank you, Alec.
Thank you very much. Bye, guys. See you soon.
Okay, guys. Lots of questions coming in. I know that a lot of you would have loved to get Alec's response, but he's the director of the movie, so we're losing him. But we do have the producer here, Hadil. We have the cast here. We have the effects team, and I would actually like to start bringing in cast members for you to meet. So why don't we start with Camille and Lance? You want to guys come on in? Lance and Camille?
Yes.
I mean, you're playing grandfather and granddaughter after all.
Why did you have to say it? I was going to say it.
Oh, you're going to reveal it? I'm sorry. Forget what I just said.
He always rips all my lines off.
So guys, yeah. Lance, tell me about this lovely lady.
I know.
And the part she plays in this movie.
She's fantastic. We haven't seen each other in a while. I've seen her, like, around 14 or something, and then she went to high school, you know, got into college and stuff, and now I'm meeting a full-grown granddaughter on this ship, because it's my ship. And she's gonna come aboard and do some work. And I see her for the first time and I can't believe my eyes. So it's a very wonderful thing to be able to play in a movie is love and affection for somebody. And it's very easy with this one. Take a look.
How's it for you, Camille, to be working with Lance in this movie?
You know, obviously I've grown up watching his performances and being around people who appreciate him as such a sci-fi god.
Oh god! Oh wow!
But I didn't realize what has surprised me is the emotional depth that Lance brings to every single scene, and how easy it is to act with that. How much that brings out of me because he is so. He said earlier, I can't lie. I can't lie, and I know that none of these moments between Sadie and Graf are lies. It's all honest, yeah. Honest emotion, and it can't help but make me feel, feel all the affection and love of a grandfather.
Now I'm going to set the stage for you guys a little bit about their relationship and what we're doing without giving away the movie. Her grandpa, right here, Captain Graf. Owns and runs the Harbinger, a crabbing boat, and the ship. A vessel?
Boat is something you carry on a ship.
Professor Stephen Wood views
vessel.
Boat yeah.
And
ship.
And his granddaughter is a
graduate student.
A graduate student in studying sea life and climate change. I'm her professor. I play her Professor Stephen. And Camille has somehow gotten her Professor Stephen and what's Giovanni's character's name?
Ronell.
Ronell, her cohort, to take our scientific research on to Grandpa's boat.
And I give him a gift and say, yes, you can come on free.
Yeah, you know, we're saving the university lots of money that we can put towards our research.
That's exactly what, thank you.
And I can't go much further than that, but suffice it to say on this boat, you have a group of scientists, me, Camille, and Giovanni, you'll meet Giovanni, and then a bunch of crab fishermen, and you can imagine some of the conflict that happens there. So let's stick with you for a second, Camille. You're kind of the heroine of this film. I don't want to go too far into the details, but how has it been working on a practical effects movie for you and being surrounded by all this real stuff and all this wonderful?
I had an experience filming a huge budget film in Louisiana, and I played a witch ghost, and I was supposed to work for a couple weeks on the film, but after the first week, they told myself and the other girl playing witch ghost that we wouldn't be needed because we were going to be replaced by digital versions of ourselves. Aww. We went for half a day in the studios, and we were scanned. They did body scans of us in our costumes, and then we sat in chairs like this in front of a camera with an iPad that had 16 different facial expressions. And I, fear, sad, happy. And I asked the supervisor who was there if I should be creating these emotions for them or just replicating the faces. And he said, just replicate the faces. So it was a pretty horrifying experience for me to think. I know that this happens to creatures. Creatures lose their jobs all the time to digital versions of themselves. But it was the first time that it occurred to me that actors, it could happen to actors as well. Mm-hmm. And so I just think it's a little scary that this digital obsession is kind of permeating every level of filmmaking. And like you guys were talking about earlier, it is important. It's an important element, definitely. But I think there's nothing like a real performance from an actor. There's nothing like a real performance acting of an actor acting opposite
well,
a real
know,
creature.
All of the 10,000 emotions that get you to any one of the ones you stated are missing.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Right. So, I mean, and that's a perfect example of the little organic moments that you miss out on when you don't have an actual creature or something tangible, something tactile, performing and moving and existing with you.
Have there been some highlights on this set? You can't really reveal too much, unfortunately.
No.
Has there been any?
Well, this morning we had a fun action scene with lots of tentacles, and I got whipped in the face a few times.
Okay.
And
can
you know,
say that.
And it brings tears to it brings you. You feel that initial sting, and your eyes well with tears, and that's real. And if you know, if we had to be dodging fake things, that you would know. It's electric for us.
When you have
the
opportunity to whip an actress with tentacles, do it. It's going to help her performance. I think that's really the takeaway.
You know, I got a story. Jim right? Cameron asked me to come down when they were doing Avatar. He said, come down and see what we're doing, Lance, because I could record you, and then I wouldn't even need you for another movie. And I said, I'm not coming down for that. You got to be kidding me. You think I'm going to walk into the dragon's mouth?
I mean, yeah.
No. But that's... Could be where it's going on some level.
You know. Although I think when you talk about budgets, there's nothing cheaper than just turning on a camera and pointing at a person.
Yeah.
I don't think that'll ever be replaced. Okay, wait, I'm going to hit some questions here, guys. Timo Jurinen? Jurinen? I hope I'm saying your name correctly. Timo Jurinen? Nice to see how relaxed everybody is. You have a great crew, I bet. Greetings from Finland. Tell us about the crew. Tell us about, from both your perspective, the family that's come together to make this happen. Because it really is a family.
You just said it all.
It's, yeah.
It became a family.
Yeah.
I mean, the bonding that took place between all of us, you know, it only took 4 days. Once we started, we realized we're relying on each other so totally that it became a family. I mean, even the division between her crew that she brought on and ours, we marveled at our differences, which was kind of great.
Yeah.
As far as the crew behind the camera, it's a small one, but everyone is so focused and dedicated and working longer hours than I would have thought possible. And what's so exciting is that I think Alec has brought together a group of veterans like the Skotaks and Pat McClung, brought those people, those experts in the field, to work with newcomers like myself and Frank Balzer, who created this incredible set. And
we're going to meet Frank, by the way, and he's going to tell you how this happened, hopefully.
Kyle Wilson, production designer. So he really went out on a limb and took chances on young people. And threw them into the arena with all of these old pros, and everybody is learning so much.
Old pros.
And,
oh, you're not that old.
I hate that word, old.
I mean,
what is old?
Seasoned.
We
have the life expectancy of a housefly.
No.
How are we old?
That's true.
We just get wrinkled.
That's true.
You could say wrinkled.
That's it is. There's no old or young. There's wrinkled and smooth.
And colors fade.
That's right.
So
well,
we're going to need Lance.
Okay, that's perfect because it's now time to swap in a few actors.
Yes.
We want you guys
I got
to meet,
go to work.
Say goodbye to Lance. He's
okay,
going to go back
I'll see
to the set.
Down the road.
Say goodbye to Camille. She's going to go back to the set. I want a hug, though, because you're
goodbye.
The pretty lady. Thank you, Camille. And who's standing by? We have Reed. We have Giovanni. We have Mike. The three of you want to come on in? I'm going to stand up so you guys can use these three chairs. Well, we have Rennell. So, guys, we're going to bring in three more cast members. Mike, who you've met, come on in, dude. Who plays Doc.
Hello, hello.
And Reed, who plays Bowman. Come on in, man. Grab a seat, and we'll bring Rennell in as well.
By the way.
Oh, Giovanni.
I just watched Thanks for Sharing.
Oh.
Which, any of you guys haven't seen it, go see it.
Thank you, dude.
It's on Netflix, Video on Demand, all that stuff.
Yeah.
He wrote it. It's amazing. It's different from this, but it's...
It has nothing to do with...
It's very impressive.
Monsters, just internal monsters. Now it's called Thanks for Sharing. Check it out.
But he put together an incredible movie.
Thank you.
An incredible cast, and I enjoyed it.
Thanks,
on
Reed.
My couple days off.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Congrats on that.
So we're just waiting on Giovanni. Come
Giovanni,
join us.
Hey, babe.
Oh, you want to sit and tweet about it?
You want to watch yourself as you do your interview?
That's so meta.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes, I was trying to tweet it to my friends.
She's tweeting her.
No, you can tweet while you're sitting here.
I thought that was rude.
Let's go to, I've already kind of introduced you, but let's go down the line and make it official. Let's start with you, Mike. And
Hello.
Tell us about your character and who you play in the movie.
Hello, my name is Mike Estime. I play Doc. I would say the character that is most...
talkative.
Very much talkative, just like I am in real life. So to really work for this character wasn't really that hard. But no, I am talkative, but I think the reason why also is that it was just very enjoyable to play a character. And just like myself, I do have a somewhat of a filter. Not much, but somewhat, but Doc has no filter. And he really lets people know the way he feels, the way he thinks. It's a gut reaction. It's nothing from the head. Even though he is very intelligent in what he says, but he's also very reactionary, which is a nice little dichotomy of what the character's about, which is what I liked about the script. And really, really cool and really overwhelmed and really, and also working with these beautiful actors, and I can say beautiful. Yeah, it's good, you know, in a very beautiful way. I think I've said beautiful enough that I've learned so much. So that's what my hello. Watch my light. Thank you. Thank you. This is kind of you know you can't. Yeah, we got it. You see, this is what we have to deal with. But anyway.
So that's Mike.
That is me. I just keep talking until I just have.
Now we're gonna
to
go over to Reed. Reed, tell us
Mike
about yourself. Tell us about
to give Giovanni time to tweet out to her fans.
Right. Did you tweet
Mike,
it out?
No problem.
I
appreciate
it. Out to everybody. I hope you guys see it.
Why don't we go to Reed last because he's a dude? Why don't we go to the pretty lady, Giovanni? Tell us about yourself. Tell us about your character in the movie.
Hello, everybody. I'm Giovanni Samuels. I play Rennell. I am. Camille/Sadie's friend, and I'm also a student as well. We're doing the research together, and that's how we end up on the boat. I'm having a blast here. This is like one of my actor's bucket lists is to be in something like this. And, you know, I kind of grew up watching all these horror films and whatnot, and to actually be a part of, you know, the guy who created it is even awesomer, so yay.
And, awesome. We'll get back to you. We're going to have some discussion with the fans. Why don't we head over now to Reed? Introduce yourself. Tell us about your character, dude.
Hi, guys. My name's Reed Collins. I'm playing Bowman. And first, I want to say thanks to all of you guys. Because I was lucky enough to be involved in this project from a pretty early stage. As if you guys saw the trailer, I had a little less of a beard, but I was in that, which isn't related to what actually happens in the movie, just so you know. But I really do appreciate all this love you guys have given us and making this thing possible. So,
well, thank you. It's great to have you guys here live. We think this fits in the spirit of the movie to invite the fans into the process because the fans are the reason this happened. How has it been for the three of you working on this as opposed to a typical project that's funded in a typical way?
I think there's a spirit about this project that is rare and exciting. You know, on days off, the actors are here because we want to be part of it.
Yeah.
Everybody's working so hard with such enthusiasm, and it's really a special thing. I mean, I think Alec is so receptive to us. Like he's a great director in that he's steering the ship. He knows exactly what he needs and what he wants, but you can talk to him. There's an open dialogue. And that, as an actor, I think, is so important because you're not just locked into this machine that's churning forward and there's so much money thrown at it, and then, you know, we can figure things out as we go.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's lost in some other forms of filmmaking where it's just, we're in a tight schedule, we spent this much money, this is what's gonna be, and if we don't get it, we'll figure it out in post.
Yeah, we pre-vised every emotional moment and we can't vary from that.
Right,
right.
And what about you, Mike? How does this feel? Just sort of the budget, the crowd aspect of it, the family feeling, is it different from other
things? It is different in the sense of the family feel of it. And I don't know.
Oh, we gotta whisper. Oh, quiet. It's okay. Getting close to him.
Yeah, you get real close. Get your eyes.
They're rolling.
Yeah. So it's the quietest I've ever been.
It's true.
It is. So in the sense of the budget feel and the family feel, what I look at, I mean, I never really looked at the movie as far as budget-wise, but even with this, it doesn't feel like the budget had anything to do with it. It's just the people in itself. And I think what Reed had to say regarding Alec and the people that are involved, the producers and everything, they're finding out, how are you doing? Are you okay? And then Alec coming in, okay, let's work with this. Whereas I was fortunate to be on like very small roles in other movies, and I never saw the director say, hey, let's work on this, or what do you feel about this, or take their, I mean, God forbid, their advice on what the characters may be thinking. And I think that's what's so great about being on this project. And like you said, I love to come to work, meaning I couldn't wait for the next day. I mean, I'd be exhausted after the day was over. But then I would be like, oh, I gotta go to work, gotta get to work, gotta be here on time. So it was like Christmas every day for me. And
also he's lying. You cannot exhaust this guy.
I'm always running. Yeah, I just.
We worked it. Like 13 hours, days. Yeah. Everyone came in the next morning like, oh my God, did you guys sleep so well? And he goes,
he starts singing show tunes in the middle of the day and just starts.
I think we should turn this into a musical. Harbaging down, harbaging down.
All day is just show tunes nonstop.
Like, energy.
It's just for days.
It's a beautiful thing. But that's what happens. This doesn't feel like work to me. Yeah. When you come in here, it doesn't feel like work.
Right.
Well, it's not work. We're doing what we love.
I think the best part about it is like everybody came in with the same mindset. Like, we're doing this for the fans. We're doing this for you guys. Like, yeah, little things were cut here and there. Yeah, it's maybe a little below budget, but it doesn't have that sense, that feel at all. Like, it's for the art. It's for the love of this movie. And, you know, everybody has that same mindset. And we're all enjoying ourselves and having a really good time in the process. Yeah. Oh, and shout out to Eric. He keeps tweeting me. Like, I guess he's seeing it.
we're gonna leave Eric. Off with you, Giovanni. Mm-hmm. Final question, and then we're going to bring in Winston, and I think we should talk to Frankie Balzer and Hadil if you want to sit down. No, not interested. Talk to us about your highlight. You were saying you were excited to work on one of these movies, one of these monster movies. Tell us what it's been like to be on set with creature effects. You can't get too specific because we can't give anything away.
I can't give anything away.
What's it been like being around this stuff?
Just seeing the entire process, we kind of came in like a month or so before we all started shooting to the workshop to see them build the creatures and whatnot. And, I'm speaking to my inner nerd, I was elated, like the whole from start to finish, and then to see it on set here, when it was just like a drawing and now you're actually seeing it and it's hitting you in the face or whatever the case may be. It's totally mind blowing. And it truly is an art, and this is why we're doing this film. This is why we're bringing this back. It's, we don't want it to be a relic. We don't want it to be a lost art. This is what it is, and this is so needed, like, for today's films, because it makes it more real. It's just something better to work off with, all around for everybody, I guess.
Yeah, without giving anything away, during a particular scene, I know no one needed to act to react to. And I'm sure that's been for all of them, just having that stuff there. It's just,
my God.
Here.
It, it
It's just happening.
And if you were asked to fake that?
You couldn't fake that. There's no way in the world you could have faked that.
That's one thing. Physically, I have so much more, so much more respect and so much more just admiration for people that are able to keep focus with either goo or this or that just on their body, because you have to have you have to maintain a focus.
Yeah, you have to stay in the moment.
You have to stay in the moment and then to keep going and just stay there, recreate it, just and get that emotion going. That was the best thing for me as an actor. Mm-hmm. And I think the fans would love that. The fans would be blown away. So
you guys are in for a major treat. Like, hold on to your seatbelts, get everybody together, because this movie is like beyond awesome.
Harbinger Down. Boom, baby. And look out for the musical Harbinger Down.
No
musical.
No.
James Brown.
James Brown.
No.
Fukushima.
Well, thank you guys for sitting with us. We're going to interview Winston. We're going to interview the special effects team. But we might see you back on set.
Yeah.
We're going to roll some more. But thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. High fives. High fives.
Boom.
Yeah.
Three awesome cast members from Harbinger Down. I'm not going to tell you their fates, but I'm sure you can guess. Hey, Winston. There are two Winstons on this movie.
Three. How are you?
Doing good. How are you?
This is Big G, everyone.
Big G's in the house.
And he lives up to his name. Have a seat.
I should probably put two of them together.
And can someone find Frankie Balzer and the effects team? I'd love to talk to Frankie and whoever else is working with Frankie.
Frankie's on set right now, but as soon as he's done doing what he's doing.
Okay. Hey, dude.
Hey.
How are you? Welcome to
doing
the broadcast.
Great. Thank you.
First mate.
First mate of the ship.
First mate. Wouldn't you feel comfortable knowing you had a first mate who looked and acted like this? You'd feel covered.
This is how I look and act when I'm being happy. Sometimes I'm grumpy.
You don't want to see him grumpy.
That's usually when I'm hungry.
We keep him very well fed on set. Tell us a little about yourself. Tell us about your character. Introduce yourself to the fans.
Well, I'm Winston, the other Winston.
Yes.
And my character is Big G. I'm the first mate on the ship. And basically, it's a big, fun, happy ship with a lot of guys and one girl. And we have some interesting people that jump aboard.
The scientists.
For a long voyage that ends up interesting.
Yeah.
As to what I could say.
Getting a little messy.
Yeah.
Maybe some monsters.
You know, definitely some monsters, which are very interesting acting with seeing all that come to life, you know, and seeing something that can come to life and be scary, you know, and see how it comes to life, you know. It's not a real monster, but it seems so realistic. You know? We have Reed and Camille behind the camera, livening up.
Camille, you want to come back in? You have a special relationship with this guy.
You know?
I'm going to bring... Here, sit here. Sit here.
Yeah, no.
Actually, sit next to Big G.
I was just off screen, off camera, doing a little dance that Lance made up.
There's
that's
a whole,
the Harbinger Down dance. It could be in the musical.
That's the drop it like it's Harbinger Down.
So as you guys can hear in the background, there's some dying going on, or something like that, maybe. Very close by. So that's the screams you're hearing. Mm-hmm. That's the fun of being on a horror set, is you get to hear horrifying things all day long. What's it been like working with this big gentleman? And what's it been like working with this young lady?
I could start by saying working with her has been great. You know, I like the... Seems very well polished as an actress, you know, I like her smoothness with the delivery of the lines, and, you know, it's a real treat to work with some real talented people, you know. It kind of sort of rubs off on you.
I have fun working with him because I'll just, like, punch him in the arm or
hang
on his
nothing.
Shoulder.
He feels nothing.
No, the great thing about Winston is that he's so open to approaching things in lots of different ways. I think it's easy as an actor to get stuck in different deliveries or different, like you find an emotion that you think works and you hang on to it and you don't let it go. But Winston is so open to trying new things and experimenting and playing.
Yep.
And And he's so hardworking. I mean, he had an entire career before he decided to act. Wow. And so he's relatively new.
Relatively.
To the game, but he's
well, he makes winning.
Winston, what was your previous career?
I was a bodyguard.
Bodyguard.
Yep.
Taking care of people.
Four.
Taking care of people. All I right. worked for one of two special people.
All right. Oh, you're not allowed to mention.
Oh, I'm. You know, one of them was Snoop Dogg. You know, definitely. Right. I mean, and just being around him was you know, he's a great person to be around because I don't know too many people that work as hard as he does. You know, and you get to travel the world. You know, and as you're traveling the world, you get to see this person. That, you know, is a human being that's finding some way to stay up all these hours and work. And it kind of makes, you know, it kind of makes you become a harder worker. And then coming into a set like this where we work 12 hours and things like that, you know, it's you know, it almost feels like you just flow into it, you know? So it's like it's a whole different type of career I was in, but it still teaches you the hard work that you need for this type of career, because acting is not all that easy, you know? Coverage with 9 people, you know. Hey.
Wait, so you could be on a jumbo jet traveling around the world with Snoop Dogg or hang out with us on an icy deck in Chatsworth.
Exactly.
And you chose the icy deck in Chatsworth. Come on. I love you.
You know, icy deck.
Chose us over. You're crazy. I would so choose Snoop Dogg.
But he's gonna talk to Snoop about recording a version of Drop It Like It's Harbinger.
Drop It Like It's Harbinger.
Drop nice. It Like It's Harbinger down.
Now, you have a special relationship with Lance in this movie.
Definitely.
He is your rock. So what was it like working with a legend like Lance Henriksen?
I mean, from the first time he started talking, I mean, from the first time he spoke his lines, I was like, wow, I mean, he's polished. And it's like, just the way he sounds, so comfortable. And it's like, you know, I noticed, like, the way he, like, in the scenes, like, it's like he really feels, you know, what's going on and, you know, takes his time to really, you know, like, you know, make it a part of him, the scene almost, you know? And it's something about the way he does that is just so, I mean, he's done so many movies and he has so many more to come. So, I mean, I think it's just, you know, the experience that he has, but seeing him be so polished and so, you know, just make things seem easy. It's something good to be around, you know? He's a legend and is, you know, definitely. And it's always beautiful to be around legends, you know?
Well, I know for my part, when we all first meet him in the movie is a scene where we're on the boat, the whole cast is gathered there, the scientist, and we're chattering about something, and he steps in and drops a line, and I know I felt it on set that day. I'm like, we got a movie here. You know, yep. It's like Lance Henriksen shows up,
yep.
An icon of this genre, and anchors the film from the moment he hits the screen, and it's been a dream come true. I've known the man since I was 7, but I've never had the chance to work with him. And
wow.
It's been an awesome thing to be sharing scenes with him.
Yeah. So,
Pumpkinhead, oh my gosh, Ed Harley. He was the star of my dad's directorial debut. Mm. Oh, I was an extra in Pumpkinhead. We didn't get any.
We don't talk about that.
No, but Lance and I get to go toe-to-toe in this movie. And,
yeah.
It was pretty humbling. I was like, he's gonna kick my ass. It's Lance Henriksen.
I had a great scene with this guy in the movie.
Yes, we did.
You know, he's the same. I mean, everybody is super talented around here. I mean, it's just, you know, and in that in of itself almost makes it feel like, you know, I feel blessed, really, to be a part of this project, you know? And it's like, it's, you know, you're reaching out and being able to, you know, rub shoulders with people that, you know, people would pay to rub shoulders with. So, money's
Wait,
not that.
You didn't pay to be in this movie?
I would have. Oh, wow. I got the better deal. Hello.
Hello.
Big G's in the house. You know, first mate, I guess, you know, they turned it up for me instead of them. They're not the first mate, you know? You know, only one first mate.
Do we have eyeballs on effects?
Well, Spencer wants to come in. He's actually part of the team that he and Kyle built all these sets.
Great, we can talk about sets.
He's art director.
Well, that's fantastic. Guys, right. Thank you for sitting with
thank
us.
You.
Thank we're going to talk to some of the folks behind the scenes.
Definitely.
But I had such a great time doing this with you, and I think we'll all be really proud of how it all turned out.
Oh,
and
man.
It's all thanks to the fans out there
yes.
who made it happen.
And I appreciate the fans, too. Thank you for all the love, and the Kickstarter program and making this all come together. You yeah. know? Big G's over and out.
Big G's.
Thank God I didn't break the chair.
Big G and little C, thank you guys. We're gonna welcome some of the behind the scenes artists. Hold on, we can have another. How am I gonna dead guy, please? Look at this. Have to be buried at the set visit now. That's so cool. Live in home. Hey, what's up, Spencer?
How's it going,
Matt? How are you?
Good to see you, buddy.
One of the miracle workers here. Spencer, introduce yourself. Tell us your job on the film, and we'll talk a little bit about the stuff you guys did to pull this off.
My name is Spencer Brennan. I'm an art director / props set dresser. We wear a lot of hats in the art department. I'm part of the critical team here that's been working for months to put all these sets together. And
well, we're here on this set. Why don't we talk about this set?
Let's talk about the deck.
Let's pop one of these off of the sticks, and let's have Spencer give us a little tour of the deck. How do we feel about that?
Rock and roll.
We can't pop one of these off a tripod? Bear with us. Bear with us, guys. We're going to have Spencer give us a proper little tour of this set and talk to you guys about a little bit of what it took to pull it off.
We'll talk about a little bit, yeah.
We don't want to kill the magic too much for you. So just bear with us one sec. We're going to pop one of these cameras off. Yes? Yes, Reed?
I have Blue for you.
Blue, join us.
Oh, yeah. Blue's definitely a critical yeah. part of the team.
Come on.
Blue!
Can't change it now.
Introduce yourself to the crowd. We're live right now. Tell them who you are and what you're doing on the movie.
Hi, my name is Chris, nicknamed Blue. I do props on Harbinger Down.
He does more than that. But, yeah. We have, like I said, it's kind of a mishmash of jobs, and it's really a team effort in the art department here. I don't think there's any one person that has like sat down and said like, I'm doing exactly this. Like, everybody's been contributing. You know, we had Reed on the sets like building, putting pipes on and painting and doing stuff for 2 weeks, and Blue and I were out. 3 weeks. Yeah, no. See, it was such a long, like, strenuous time, and just scrambling and going crazy and putting all this stuff together and having a good time with it. That, you know, time starts to fly.
So tell me about this set, guys. Let's talk about what it took to pull it off. We've got Jake on a roving camera, and we're just gonna follow you around for a little tour. All right. Let's try and stay within the set and not see the stuff beyond, guys.
Cool. So. Kind of starting from the base, we had our Kyle, our production designer / main builder, carpenter. The guy is a machine. He's been going crazy on these sets for months. So he starts with the foundation here of the deck, and he's building the sets and the walls and all this stuff. And then Blue and I were
adding set deck, making it look like a boat.
We were driving all around Los Angeles, Orange County, trying to find people, anyone and everyone that had something that they wanted to contribute to the project that looked like it was on a boat, you know, some kind of boating stuff. Here's our crab pot. This is actually custom made by Kyle. He came over and he welded our steel together and we tied it up. And this
is
some,
sturdy.
Yeah. Again, a lot of the stuff that's really fun about what's on this set was kind of going with the Kickstarter vibe mentality with it, is it's a very much a contribution-based set. Like, we didn't just buy everything, we didn't just make everything. Like, we had so many people that were bringing elements to this set and putting them together, and you know, so there's a lot of team spirit in every one of these kind of items here. We had some action in this pot, and it was rigged with creatures one day, so that was really fun. We went down, and Blue and I drove a truck down to Orange County once, and we grabbed a huge truck full of the nets and buoys and as many of those as we could find. It was really fun, and we went and visited our friend Bob, who lives on a boat in Marina Del Rey, and he goes, hey, man, I got some boat stuff for you. So he starts throwing it at us, and we're like, yeah, we'll take some of that, and we'll take some of this rope, and we'll take some bins. And we're kind of the professional mess makers right now. You know,
professional like, garbage pickers.
Yeah, we're picking up the garbage and making a mess and turning it into a set. Let's see, what else do we got over here? I don't want to take too much of the magic away, but some of these items in here are secret ADI backyard items. So if you've got a real eye for ADI stuff, you might be able to find a few Easter eggs in this set. We have tried to put them in there for you guys. So
definitely more in the other sets
watch
as well.
Watch Harbinger Down more than once and see if you can figure them out. What else we got?
we got going on around here. Some doodads and some recycles and things, so.
Would you guys feel up to giving them a tour of the galley hallways?
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely.
That'll be a good one, yeah.
Okay. We got a camera in there?
Yeah.
So why don't we fly you guys over there?
Sounds good.
And when I get a signal from my guys, we'll switch over and find you in the galley in those hallways.
Cool.
We can talk about those.
Rock and roll.
So head over there now.
Sweet, definitely.
So I really love that you guys are getting a chance to meet the crew as well, because obviously, you know, we actors get most of the attention, but most of the work, 99.9% of the work is done by all the artists behind the scenes. And Spencer and Blue are awesome. You're also going to meet the creature effects crew at the end of this broadcast. We might go a little long because we have to end with those guys, Tim Martin and Yuri from ADI. But before we meet them, you're going to meet Frankie Balzer, who's responsible for all the snow effects and the smoke and all the awesome effects. He's been doing a beautiful job, too. So as soon as I get a signal from the crew, Ben, are you on? That we're live on the galley set. We'll switch over to that feed, and Spencer and Blue will show you some of the work they did to bring the below decks to life, which are just as cool as this above deck stuff. Ben, what do you hear?
What?
ETA? Yes? Ready to switch over?
No.
10 seconds? All right, we're going to be switching over. I will see you guys back in the galley in moments. In 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3. See you in the galley. 2, 1, bye. Yeah, yeah. Find a spot. We don't want.
Thank the Lord. Thank God.
Man, this person lost an arm and a leg.
This is a good central spot. Actually, you can see the galley, you can see the berth, and you can see some hallways. So if you're planted here, Johnny, this is a good spot. All right, guys, Spencer and Blue are going to tell you what's going on. If you stand right where they are, they can basically show you down this hall, but we don't want you to move too much.
Yeah, let's close that door. Are we ready to rock, or are we?
Yeah, we're live.
Oh, man, we are up and running.
Yeah.
All right, so here we are in the heart of the companionway. Mm-hmm. The companionway is actually kind of a cluster of sets. Cluster of sets that we put together. It's we've got a handful of hallways here. It's kind of a T-junction, and we tie together in a galley set we've had over here. A lot of action happened in this galley.
Let's see if we get a light up.
It's pretty awesome. It's darkness right now.
But look at that, all the walls.
Yeah, look at this. It's floor to ceiling, left to wall. This is a 360-degree
set.
There
we go.
Who did that?
Now,
got the light on.
Here we're talking. You guys want to drink while you're in here? We got plenty of, have some goodies here. We got all kinds of snacks,
full
and liquor,
of
and sodas and stuff in here. This is great. It's a fun time. Every once in a while, the crew comes in and we just have a big galley party. It's awesome.
Pictures of all the crew.
There's actually some photos of the past crew members up here on this wall. Let's see. Where's one of them? Oh, here's one. Who's that? That's actually me.
Come back here.
Part of the fun that we had on this set, we all got to take some photos of ourselves and get dressed up and really enjoy.
We got pictures of people that have helped out just randomly, been able to come on for a couple days and, lend a hand helping make Harbinger Down actually become a dream come true.
Yeah, getting part of that whole contribution vibe. We really wanted to get everyone involved that was helping out, and we had so many extra hands here during the builds and painting the ceilings and putting pipes up and really adding the character and the detail that's going to bring the set to life. And we thought this was a really great way to kind of throw back and make sure everybody has a little bit of chunk of themselves in the film. There's a little Easter egg too. One of our investors' EPs is around in the mystery photos there too. It'll be fun for him to pick that up. If we come back over here in the hall, we also connect to
Hadil.
Oh, we're not going to shoot anymore. But that's pretty good.
That was a nice segue.
Oh, appreciate it.
This is where we sleep. Not all of us in one room, but that's where a few of them sleep.
In the berth.
Have the kids really enjoyed this? You guys, you know this ship is haunted.
Okay.
It is. We hear all kinds of stuff, strange stuff, constantly. It is haunted. But you know what? You have to live with it. What are they gonna do to me?
Hey, you know what people don't know about Lance, which is, I guess if you've listened to his interviews, you do, is he's such a funny guy. And we keep, it's like all the actors are like hanging around Lance. Every time I walk by the actors' table, it's like everybody's like laughing. Lance is dancing. It's if you know his movies only, you would never guess that he has this in him. So yeah, I keep saying, right, Matt, we need to do a comedy with him.
A comedy?
Yeah, right?
We got to do your character.
They think I'm crazy or something.
That guy.
Something. Crazy or something.
It's a crazy.
No. We got to do something to light the mood. You can't go into the dark.
That's right. That's
you can't.
Right.
I will refuse to go to the dark.
Because you've.
Or something.
We had that conversation, right? Because you played so many bad guys. What kind of effect.
My career is 50-50. Bad guys, good guys. Good guys are boring. But the bad guys, you know, I try to put some humanity into them, if that's possible. I just feel like they when I play a bad guy, I'm feeling that other people just don't know how to live, and I do, you know, or something.
Or something.
And they also gave me the job. I got to do it.
Or something.
But a comedy, I would love to do it.
Has anyone ever approached
joy
you?
How many of you want to see Lance Henriksen star in a comedy, a crazy, wacky, zany comedy?
I do.
Say yes in the comments.
Come yes. on, man.
Yes in the comments. Scripts.
Want to see me in a comedy or something?
Alec, we only have like 10 minutes. We're gonna go 5 minutes over because you have yet to meet the creature effects and the floor effects teams.
Yeah.
And Alec, do you have a moment to introduce Frankie and to introduce
I'm gonna head out.
Okay.
Lance.
Love you guys. Thank you.
Big
you.
Round of applause for Lance Henriksen, Captain Graf, star of Harbinger Down.
Hey, and we should bring you to the deck of the ship. We can interview with the effects guys there.
Go back over there.
Do you want to do it on the?
That's what he's saying. He's a lot of.
Okay.
We're going to go back to the, the deck.
Let's do it.
For the three.
So, guys, we are going to talk to the creature effects team, Tim Martin, Yuri. We're going to talk to Frankie and Alec right now.
Can I give a couple of shout outs to people who have been texting me?
Yes, give some shout outs.
Jeff Birch. Jeff Birch is our amazing graphics guy who did the posters that you've seen.
Great.
The Harbinger Down posters. He's also done graphics for us on that show up on computer screens and stuff, weather satellite stuff. Genius guy, Harbinger Down supporter. Mo Gomeo, she just texted me. I was only kidding that I didn't know who you were, all right? Who was it that said nice beard? Oh, that was Jeff.
Oh, there were a lot of beard comments.
Beard comments,
a lot of people are loving the beards.
Yeah, the beards are good, right? Of the cast?
There's a lot of beards.
Come on, I almost made the women wear them, too.
I showed up to the table read wearing a beard.
That's
and I
right,
said to you right after, I said, I'm shaving Alec. Every man in this film is bearded.
Yeah, and you can't compete with them.
I shaved my entire body for Alec.
Who can compete with Winston in terms of manliness?
You.
No!
Listen to that voice. And Lance Henriksen, the manliest man in the world, are here today. So we're going to head over to that deck, and we're going to give more shout-outs. I don't think we've given a proper shout-out to the Sultan, though. Do you want to say a little Dark
Sultan,
Dunes love?
Yes. I want you guys to head over to Dark Dunes Facebook, right? Because Sultan, for those of you who don't know him, he is a kindred spirit to all of us who loves horror, sci-fi, and practical effects, so much so that he is stepping into the industry. He's a very smart guy, so he's not just doing it willy-nilly. He's being very selective about what he does, and if it weren't for him, we wouldn't have the kind of production value that you guys see around you now. So hopefully we're going to have a long and fruitful relationship with Sultan, and we're doing our best for him and you as well to make a great little movie that you guys will that will elevate the art.
Thank you, Sultan. We love you. You love monsters. We love you, and you are our family from very far away.
From Abu Dhabi.
Abu Dhabi. Yep. We all have family in Abu Dhabi now. Yep. I hope you're watching this, Sultan. And we're going to head over now to the deck and we'll talk about effects.
Okay,
so,
good.
I don't think you can follow us all the way there. We're going to start to walk out, and then we'll switch over to the deck. Right, Johnny?
Has this been done before? Everybody doing this now? Huh?
Nice.
Oh, I put my...
Nice.
You did it, bro.
Jason. I need to do. Is your name actually Jason?
No, but.
Oh, I shouted it.
Do you need me to make Jason? Do you need me to make you like?
So Alec, we just need a chair for Alec, and we're gonna leave it to the four of you, and you can talk about these boys and how much they've delivered for you. One, introduce them.
Hi there, it's Alec Gillis here again. Now, I gave a shout out 2 seconds ago. There's one more I'd like to do to Jason Spear, our executive producer through Kickstarter, who has done such a fantastic job supporting us. And, you know, another guy, a big, huge cog in our machine. Thank you very much, Jason. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to our team. These are sort of our behind the scenes effects guys. He's sitting right here next to me. This is Mike Spatola. From Cinema Makeup School, and he's also our makeup department head. He's a special effects makeup artist, as well as being a straight and a beauty makeup artist. And I've known you for how long?
Since 87.
Worked for Stan Winston. Was it on Leviathan when we first?
Alien Nation, Leviathan,
right.
So on.
And so you, long time family association here. This is Tim Martin, who is ADI's main creature builder, and he's been with us for how many years?
14
for yeah,
the most part.
14. There used to be so much more.
That's the treatment you get after 14 years.
Yeah, that's what you get.
Yeah, all right.
Anyway, and this is Frank Balzer, who is our physical effects guy here. So all this snow is Frankie's responsibility, right?
Yep.
And now, Frank, we've been fortunate on the movie to have Michael Lantieri, who is our friend from way back when. You remember him from Death Becomes Her.
Jurassic Park,
Oscar huge, winner. Yeah. Quick story about Mike Lantieri. When Tom and I were working on Death Becomes Her, the news came down to us that that we could not be on the ticket for the Oscar because the visual effects guys were too many visual effects guys. There were three visual effects guys and Mike Lantieri. Mike Lantieri is the kind of guy who said, I don't need an Oscar because I didn't do that much. These guys did more. I will step down so that one of them can get his name on the Oscar. So if it weren't for Mike Lantieri, then Tom Woodruff wouldn't have an Oscar. So, and no, Mike Lantieri is a fantastic guy that we're very lucky to have as our sort of like godfather of the special effects. And Frank Balzer has been working with him, and Mike has loaned us lots of equipment and been instrumental in upgrading our efforts. And Frank is no slouch on his own. I don't mean to demean you in any way this time, but when we're on set, expect to be very brutalized. And this, of course, is Yuri Everson, who has been with ADI for
24 years.
Wow.
24.
And Yuri's basically, he goes by many titles, shop foreman among them, but he runs the shop so that Tom and I can play and just be jerks, basically run around with no responsibilities, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, let's see. What would we talk about? Are there questions, or shall I just continue talking?
People want to know a little bit about these creatures. I know you can't reveal too much, but perhaps the vibe you were going for, what was inspired, right. And perhaps the challenges you were faced with, and also how you pulled off. There's a lot of physical. Floor effects in this film.
Yeah.
And Mike can also talk about his. We'd love to get some all right. experiences
well, so, so
from these guys.
Just quickly, I'll give Tim a chance to talk, but maybe just describe what the philosophy. I don't know. I can plug my ears if you want to tell him what it's been like, because it hasn't always been.
The best, shortest way to describe that is trying to make something out of almost absolutely nothing without giving any of the creatures away.
Right.
So it's very, very low tech, but very kind of high, concept, that's a good one. Sure.
Yeah, we're looking for translucency and bioluminescence, right? And the materials that you might normally go to if you have a ton of money are not really the materials we've gone to in this case. But there's a really great sort of texture and life to the way we've approached it. A lot of direct construction techniques that you can learn about on the Winston School. Tell us about your challenges as the makeup department.
Actually, my job's been pretty easy on this gig. The guys don't wear a lot of makeup, just dirt under the nails and stuff, and we only have a couple of female cast members. So the straight makeup part of it has been really easy. When we're killing people, which we do on this film, there's a little bit more involved. Matt Winston's... was pretty interesting.
Maybe. Spoiler alert!
I mean...
Matt Winston can attest to how fantastic
the work has been.
Yes, and I was very excited by a sort of an out of the kit thing that Mike did that sort of changed the way I was looking at stuff. The great thing is when you have talented people like this around, you're like, I don't know, show me something. What do you got? And generally speaking, they have knocked it out of the park beyond my expectations. Snow, for instance,
that's
Frank
a big
Balzer.
Challenge.
Yeah, tell us about your snow. Life.
Yeah, Frankie.
Snow Life. I've been doing it for a long time, kind of labeled as a snow guy, and this is some of my work that I've started ahead. I've done a lot of commercials as well.
Right. And when you said, I can do, how many stages? I'm saying, well, there's three stages. One is no snow, the other is light snow, and the other is, I'd really like kind of a lot of snow, but I'm not expecting.
Icy snow.
And then it was like this. I came in, he did it over the weekend, right?
Yeah. Two other guys.
How long did it take you to do this whole thing?
12 and a half hours.
12 and a half hours.
Four or three guys.
And it's like cotton batting and
Batting, wax. We used acrylic icicles, and then a lot of paper product.
Fantastic.
Yeah,
I came in, I was like, whoa, that's twice as much snow
Frankie,
as I ever
tell,
thought.
Tell the folks about this stuff. Here.
Oh,
can you get a zoom in on
this stuff
that?
Right here. Well, there's all sorts of gunk in here. Look, there's trash. There's different flakes of wax that we had on the ground. We laid it up, and then we threw Epsom salt on top of it to actually make it look like frozen ice. Then this other product in here, which is paper, it's really high-quality shredded film paper. This type of stuff has been fire-treated for indoors on set, and it's also biodegradable. We use it outside all the time on city blocks, and we just clean it up, sweep it up, hose it down with the hose, and it's gone.
Tell them about your soap suds.
The soap suds. We actually use soap suds as falling snow.
Which means that you've got a machine that whips it into suds
and
blows it out, and then we blow
it
the
fans. Then we hit it with other fans to actually project it a lot farther.
And what I love about it, aside from the lightness of it and how it swirls and hits the eddies of the air and all that stuff, is that when it hits a person or the ground, it dissipates and it melts. It basically goes away like real snow. So you don't have all this residue that the paper snow.
Yeah.
So that's great for the lighter stuff, and it also isn't just like clogging in people's clothing and in their hair. The only downside would be that it makes it a little slippery.
A little bit.
But we clean that out. Hell, creature slime makes things slippery too. Yeah. Tell us about what it's like. You were supervising the stuff in the shop. I know Tim was carrying the brunt of the actual build. Tim is our one-man wrecking machine on this. Mm-hmm. That's a fond, that's a good thing.
Yeah,
he's just been like, you know, he because basically because he can't work with anyone and no one wants to work with him.
Hey! No, I will tell you, Stan Winston School loves Tim Martin. Yeah.
Come on, he's just, know, he's we're just, family.
Yeah. Keeping me for himself.
Well, he had to put up with you before yeah. he no, found truly, other friends.
Truly,
we'll take you.
Truly, no, Tim is our secret weapon on this show in terms of his output and the stuff he's done. Hey.
I play for a new team.
That's right.
What? We're all Stan Winston family. Where's my hat? Where's my hat?
I need a hat.
Anyway, so he was. But tell us what it's like from a supervisorial standpoint.
Yeah, it's funny. You do mention Tim a lot, and Tim has done a lot, but there's a whole bunch of.
I don't mean to say that he's the only guy.
There's a whole bunch of crew members back at ADI.
It was just me.
Name them. A ton of stuff.
Stan Winston School loves Yuri.
Yeah, no, of course. We've had Matt Killen, we've had Mike Larrabee, yeah. our standard guys. Yeah, I don't mean to say.
Garth,
no,
Brian.
Yes, Garth, Brian, right?
A ton of people.
An army of right? people working yeah. on it. Why yeah. do you try to take credit this way? This is what I'm talking about.
And what about the interns?
And the interns.
Who? Yeah.
No,
yeah.
we had interns yeah. from Cinema Makeup School.
Yeah.
And they have sent us high-quality interns. I've been so impressed with the kids. Kids. I mean, they're like, you know, to me, everybody's a kid.
Yeah.
But no, they've done a great job, and you know, they come in with a great attitude, and we try not to abuse them, but give them some experience that they can take away with them.
Yeah. We have two of them on the makeup department with me, and then Patty, who's been working here on the set, painting and helping with special effects and creature effects, and you know, it's wonderful to have. What, at the shop, we've had over a dozen come and work as interns.
Yeah.
It's great for them. It's great for the school publicity, of course, but it's just they're getting wonderful experience, and so I'm really proud of them.
Yeah, again, without giving anything away, there's so much going on in this film that we needed a lot of people.
Yeah.
So a lot of people to, you know, lend their own time to it was great because it is, you know, budgetary constraints, time constraints, all that kind of stuff. So we had a ton of people that, you know, were very, very helpful.
A question has been asked along the lines of the work you guys have done, and it's been asked several times, most recently by Langley West. Is there one creature in this movie? Or are there several? Do you feel comfortable answering that, Alex?
Yeah, there's more than one creature.
Yes.
There is more than one creature for sure.
Yes, for sure.
We have a big appetite on this movie, and so does our monster. I don't know.
Good question, Langley.
I just got a question, if I may. It says, tell us about your amazing YouTube editor, Michael Heinzelman.
Oh, yes.
It's from Michael
Heinzelman. Wait, Stan Winston School loves Mike Heinzelman.
Yes, he has edited most of our YouTube videos. And as well as that, Mike Larrabee has done music for them as well. So please check them out.
I see Alec getting in a lot of hot water.
What?
Not giving enough shout-outs.
Yeah, please.
Do you want to just go through the crew list? It'll give you 20 seconds. That's not the crew list.
Lance Henriksen.
I had to do that.
I have to. You mean the
Hadil? So we're gonna bring Hadil in. Stick around, guys. Hadil, come in. Hadil Retta, one of the producers on the film. Who you met at the beginning? Yes, she's a lady. Get up. What's wrong with you? Okay, what's wrong with you?
Here, take my water.
No.
So, Hadil.
I'll take my phone charger.
Since we're closing out the broadcast, can you help Alec remember all the people who need to be thanked?
Jennifer Tung.
Jennifer right Tung. Tung. Just Jennifer start Tung. Going through it.
Jennifer Tung, who produced our Kickstarter campaign, took us through to success, is a producer on Harbinger Down. Of course, we've got Tom Woodruff. We're at Ben Brown, our director of cinematography, whose stills you are starting to see. They're not all his because he's a perfectionist. He's like, make sure everybody knows I shot that and didn't shoot that one, right? But when you start seeing footage, you guys are going to be blown away by Ben's work.
Sazzy,
our first AD, Tom Shell, our line producer, UPM Kelly K. Pat McClung is working with. Who are the people in the house right now?
Slow. Spencer, work your way Blue. From first no. AD to UPM down. Go for it.
What, that wow. order? What, we're ranking people now?
It's going to take an hour to get to my name.
Yeah, photographic memory.
No, I'm good.
Helena, PAs, Glenn, PAs, wonderful cast who you've met. I'm not going to rattle them off. I could, but I'm not. John Sound, I don't know his last name.
Mila Bjorn, we didn't
Mila
have
Mila Bjorn,
here today.
You didn't have her on, and she is a terrific actor. And I don't know if, boy, go to Dark Dunes, you'll see a picture
what about
of her.
Roland?
Roland is our other, Craig Sturtz is our other Kickstarter pledger who's in the movie. And Roland is, well, you can look on the Kickstarter campaign and see what happens to him. I'm not saying he lives or dies, good deal. I know that we're trying to keep some secrets here, but they can find that out. Who else? Come on, people.
Well, look, if you haven't been mentioned in this broadcast, it's not my fault, it's Alex's fault. But you will, for all of you watching, go to the Harbinger Down Kickstarter page, go to the Harbinger Down IMDb page even, and you're going to be seeing some of the cast and crew.
Do we have that? Do we have an IMDb?
Yes, there is.
Really?
And we will make sure when this video is released to add a complete cast and crew list in the blog we post so that everyone who worked so hard to make this happen gets the shout out, because it really is a huge village to make this happen.
And there's more people, more involvement to come too, because we're just starting to get into the, you know, we're not even into post-production. So that's a whole nother bunch of people that are going to be coming aboard and helping us out. You know, we had the whole street team of Christopher Moonlight and Jason Copley.
Yes.
Yeah, Copley. And all those guys that helps us, the Lamps Plus people. Lamps Plus, shout out to Lamps Plus.
Casting director, Joey Paul.
Joey Paul, our casting director. You know, so we just had a tremendous team here that we're so, so lucky for. I didn't realize it was like an acceptance speech.
You turned it into one.
No, you asked me to. You asked me to.
No.
List everyone who worked on the movie.
I totally did. I did.
Mike Larrabee and Joel McNeely will be doing the music. I don't know.
He's
a great painter. He's our ADF painter.
We are going to take you to the final location, which is where the rest of the crew is now, so you can see everyone eating. We're in the lunchroom with our final camera. That's where we're going to say goodbye to you guys. But right now, we're going to bid adieu to this beautiful deck, and we will see you over by the food.
Thank you, guys.
All right, so stay tuned for our final goodbye.
Thank you.
Watch the cables.
Switching?
Give me someone on headset, Dan.
Can you hear them? Can you hear them?
And then Scott, I'm all yours.
Great, you're here.
Yeah.
Okay, it looks like we're in the lunchroom. Hello. And we need someone to operate this and show everyone. Oh, they're filming us. Well, are we? Thank you. Are we live right now?
Are we still live?
Hello.
Thank you.
Yeah, I live in a right now.
Okay.
Live.
I'm going to assume we're live. Here we are.
Hi, guys.
Everyone's having lunch.
It's lunchtime.
Do I have a thumbs up? Are we live? Are they on this feed? Okay, I'm going to assume we are. This has been a hugely successful broadcast, our first live broadcast on a set. And this is something most of the world never gets a chance to see. We hope some of you, or all of you, have sort of absorbed the feeling of this. It's a very exciting place to be in, especially on this film. And I would love for you guys to pan around and see how many people it takes. And this is a small film, but it still takes a lot of people. Everyone, while you're eating, you're live around the world. Can you wave? Wave. Wave. All right, we're going to pan around. Everyone say goodbye.
This is a shot of Mike with food in his
mouth. What are we eating today?
We got chicken.
Everyone wave to the camera. All right, and we thank all of you for joining us for this very special event, especially Alec Gillis, the creator of this, who brought us all together with his story and his passion to make a movie, which is something he's been wanting to do ever since I've known him, which is about 30 years now. So thank you, Alec, and the rest of the team for opening your doors. And to all of you, stay tuned for all things Harbinger Down. Like the Harbinger Down Facebook page right after this broadcast. Like the Studio ADI Facebook page, Studio ADI, all one word. Like the Dark Dunes Facebook page to see what the Sultan is up to. Any other shout-outs? I think that covers it for that. Friend request all the cast, Reed says. Camille's going to hate you for that. And Lance Henriksen's going to hate you for that.
Guys, I got like 80,000 friend requests yesterday.
So once again, it's been great visiting with you all. Look for the upload of this video later today. It'll be going straight up onto our YouTube channel. If you missed any of it, you can watch it from the beginning. And quickly, thanks to Team Stan Winston School. Moving around the horn, we got Chris Truman on sound. We got Andy Franco, web marketing. There's Andy. We got Eric Lidoff, over here, co-founder. Ben's coming around slowly. I'm Matt Winston. There's Eric Lidoff.
You can't get around.
Here, get your head in there, Eric.
Hi.
There's John Ailes, creative director.
We got no light. Here. No light.
Come on, get in the camera so Ben doesn't.
Hey, can you back up all here? Right.
Come on, David.
John Ailes, creative director.
David, hard day to find light.
For, David Sanger, lead content producer.
Hi. I want to see Chris Truman.
We saw Chris Truman. Okay. Ben Saltzman is on camera. You want to show him yourself, Ben? We've got Yukako back switching feeds.
She's way far away.
We've got Chris Vaughn moderating. Did I cover everyone?
All these beautiful everybody? Lunch people.
And Teresa!
Teresa Laura is here.
Teresa's here too, so thank you to the Stan Winston crew as well.
Alec Gillis.
And let's leave it on Alec Gillis.
Eating.
Cut out the broadcast whenever you want, guys. Keep eating until we say the broadcast is over, Alec.
5 minutes.
Is there something in my teeth?